All right, everyone, I'd like to welcome you to the AIAA AV21 special panel session entitled Advocating for Scientific Study of Unidentified Aerial Phenomena, Technical Perspective with Focus on Aviation Safety. And as a side note, we have speakers both from domestic and international environments. I'm your session moderator. My name is Ed Stanton. And I was AIAA, or I am currently Chair Emeritus of the Air Traffic Management Integration Committee. I am joined today also with my co-chair of the session, Vince Schultz, who is the current chair of the Aerospace Traffic Management Integration Committee, and a co-co-chair, if you will, Nijo Abraham, who when AIAA is in the Design Engineering Technical Committee. Couple of administrative points I'd like to cover with everybody before we get started. First of all, in the order today of activity, we'll be starting first with three speakers on the panel, which will cover the area of technical characteristics of UAP. We expect that that will conclude roughly about the 12:40 timeframe Eastern Standard Time. We'll have a break of roughly 10 minutes after that. Then we'll be joined with the following three speakers who successively will be discussing the safety implications of UAP, and the time frame for that will last until about 2:10 in the afternoon Eastern Standard Time. We'll have another break, and then we're going to go into a session panel discussion, question and answers, and conclusion at that time. Now, the individual speakers, to give the audience a little bit of an idea, will follow the following procedure. There will be a brief introduction by myself. The speaker will have 20 minutes. I will be giving them a 2-minute warning towards the end, and they have all assured me that they will not follow political counterparts that consider a 2-minute warning a 5-minute allowance for further discussion. Then we will follow with a quick question and answer period for each speaker. This will be roughly 5 minutes. So in reality, everyone, that you'll get an opportunity to get about 2 questions in, and then we're going to move on to the next speaker. Now, for the record, AIAA AV21, as we are more than all aware, is the science and engineering forum and environment. Professional conduct will be expected in this session. Comments, questions, orientation that is outside of this will neither be tolerated nor permitted. Now let's move on. The bottom line is the session will be recorded and viewable as others for about 1 month hence. So let's go ahead and get started. First up, Dr. Ravi Kapadaru. He's a planetary science from NASA Goddard Space Flight Center and lead scientist of the Sellers Exoplanet Environment Collaboration, SEEC, at NASA Goddard. His research interests are extrasolar planet habitability, atmosphere modeling and characterization, and identifying technosignatures. In 2020, he was the recipient of the NASA Exceptional Scientific Achievement Medal. So with that, let me turn it now over to you, Ravi, if you'll begin, please.
All right. Thank you, Ed. I'd like to thank the organizers, Nijo, Ed, and Vincent, and also Carmela for organizing this session. And I hope this would be a stimulating one. As Ed said, my name is Ravi Koparapu. I'm a planetary scientist at NASA Goddard. I was trained as a physicist, and my primary research interest in studying atmospheres of planets. This is my first time attending an aeronautics conference, and I thank you all for taking the time to attend this session. So my primary goal in this talk is to highlight the need for scientifically studying the unidentified aerial phenomena, or the UAP. Science is how we make progress in understanding the world around us, and it is unbiased. Even null results are illuminating, even if we find something is not there. So my hope is that after this session, there would be momentum towards a scientific study of a UAP. Next slide, please. Thank you. So before I move on, I want to actually define what an UAP means. And because I will be using this term several times, it would be good to say what it is. There seems to be no universal definition that I know of, and there are certainly other more expanded ones to define the UAP. I'll be using this definition in this talk to broadly cover the class of phenomena. So what it would be is that it's a class of phenomena observed within the Earth's atmosphere that cannot immediately be recognized as known physical phenomena or objects. We can discuss in the Q&A session regarding the merits and shortcomings of this definition if needed or if someone asks. Next slide, please. So to begin with, at the end of June, the Office of the Director of National Intelligence released a preliminary assessment on UAP for Congressional Intelligence and Armed Services Committees after a UAP task force was created last year by the Pentagon. This task force was created because of reports about UAP posing flight safety issues for US Navy personnel. You may or may not have heard about these reports that first started appearing back in 2017 when major newspapers started publishing accounts from our Navy pilots encountering some UAP. And Lieutenant Ryan Graves, who will be talking shortly, may have more to say on this. So this talk will have some reference to the report and also related to some of the phenomena from the historic viewpoint from the last several decades. Next slide, please. All right, so the report here had some summary points that I will very briefly go through. What I found to be very interesting about the report itself is that the language and the tone of the report is consistent with how we in sciences write our results in scientific publications. It was agnostic, just presenting what is known regarding the observed phenomena or the data. There was no speculation, and there are some highlights. And I've tried to highlight some of the things that I found to be interesting in the report. The first one was that most UAP they seem to be physical objects recorded by multiple sensors. The report did not make clear what kind of sensors they had and what are those readings. Some may be sensor anomalies, and what kind of those anomalies are they? It would be really good and useful to weed out the false positives so that we know there is something, a real object, or it's just a reading mismeasurement by the instrument that they're working on. The report also mentions that there are probably multiple type of the UAP, which means that there is not probably a not single explanation based on the appearances and the behaviors that they have observed. So it may not be possible to have one single explanation to explain all the class of phenomena of UAP. And that's why I made the definition. I tried to cover that definition with this, that there may not be a single one explanation that we can come up with based on what we know. Next slide, please. So there are some patterns that may be emerging according to the report, and some of them are a bit interesting. They seem to have, at least the ones I highlighted over here, some incidents, some UAP appear to show considerable speed, maneuver abruptly, no apparent clear means of propulsion, and in some cases have been known to have radio frequency emissions as well. These seem to be have the, these kind of observations, or at least the characteristics, seem to have been also observed in earlier investigations of UAP back in the 50s and 60s when it was scientifically studied. There was one aspect that they mentioned in this report, which is called signature management. I tried really hard to understand what it would be, what it means. And I think it probably is, it's there's a signature, and maybe there is a certain type of signature modifications that UAP may be exhibiting, which is only my guess at this point, beyond anything what they have not, what they have written in this report. I'll come back to these observed characteristics from this report, because it will be useful in comparing with historical studies of UAP. Can we go to the next slide, please? The report concludes suggesting that we need to collect more data, and even more, even looking in the historical radar data to understand better the patterns that we see for this UAP. The critical point here, I want everyone to remember that the critical point here is the data collection. We make advances in sciences by collecting the data and sharing the data so that, you know, we can verify false positive, we can verify the validity and so on. And so additional data is needed to know and understand the nature of UAP. And I hope that this session would be a good first step towards in that direction. Could we go to the next slide, please? Can you hear me? Yeah. Oh, great. Thank you. So I mentioned briefly in my earlier slides that some UAPs seem to exhibit similar observed characteristics described in earlier investigations back in the 50s and 60s. This is a screenshot, or at least an image of a presentation made by Professor James McDonnell, an atmospheric scientist from University of Arizona. And he presented this at the AAAS meeting, the American Association for Advancements of Sciences, and to scientifically analyze some UAP cases written in the Condon report. And Professor McDonald was a member of National Academy of Sciences and a well-known atmospheric scientist. And he had interest in this UAP phenomena. And he went through some of the cases and tried to analyze them in a very scientific, using the scientific methodology. In my opinion, this is one of the best scientifically studied or written document on UAP investigations. Coming from my science background, I feel that, and the way the report was written, it was more how a technical report, a scientific publication would be written. So I was able to connect a little bit more with it and try to go through the details that Professor McDonald went through in here. Slide 8, please, next one. Thank you. So there were four cases mentioned in this report. One of them was the RB-47 aircraft case near the Gulf Coast area back in 1957. The AIA, there was an AIA subcommittee that also had studied this and made a report of this back in 1971, which was a bit inconclusive what went on in that particular case. There were some questions that were unanswered in this particular instance. The remaining three cases also, Professor James McDonald mentioned in the report, the Science in Default report, also exhibit in all these four cases, exhibit similar behavior with what we have the report from the DNI mentions. And so there seem to be some similarity in terms of the pattern and also the observed characteristics of the objects or the phenomena that we see in James McDonald's report and also in the DNI report that that came out last month. Okay, can we go to the next slide? So there were some questions about what can we learn from these old cases, and why not just focus on the new ones? And in particular, what can we learn from this particular document that I was showing about, the science in default document from James McDonald? Next slide, please. Well, so one of the first things that we can come up with is the scientific study of UAP is not new. And there was an open discussion among scientists about the nature, even if they are misidentified or not, and it was not stigmatized. So this was, there was free thought process and exchange of ideas about what they are and how the data can be collected. Scientists like Carl Sagan and Professor McDonald, Alan Hynek, they organized conferences and talked about this topic openly. And this is a welcome opportunity. This is how we do in science conferences. This is how we share ideas in sciences. This is what the reason why we are here right now as a technological species, because we made stride. We followed the scientific method. We shared ideas here, and that's how we progress. And if we want to understand the world around us, we need to have this kind of scientific approach to understand UAP or not. We may find there's nothing to them. We may find there is something to them, but at least the approach, the scientific methodology, is what we need to do. The sharing the data is what we need to do. The document, Science in Default, is one of the, like I said, the best investigative report on this topic. And it uses the same scientific methods and the rigor and that we traditional scientists use. Even if a traditional scientist read this document, I have sent this document to some of my colleagues, and even if when they read it, the methodology seems to be fine. I mean, maybe there was some, you know, lack of data available. It's all mostly eyewitness, but the methodology is similar. So, and the important thing here is that there was no exotic physics invoked in while writing this document. The analysis was purely based on what the observed characteristics were by the respective pilots or anyone. So this is why I would say that there was a historical precedent for us to study this UAP in a scientific way, and we should do a similar thing even with the present cases as well. And the DNI report also says similar things, that we should study them by collecting the data. This is what we do. Next slide, please. So for the case study, just for as an illustration to see how we can do a little bit of scientific analysis, I'm going to take some reported instances where some UAP seem to have descended from a high altitude to sea levels in a very rapid time. Now, I want to caution that this is by no means an analysis based on an observed or collected data. If we go to the next slide, I'll explain what are the assumptions that we want to, yes. So the assumptions here are that, I'm assuming that these are not radar anomalies, if this observation is from the radar. I will also assume that the observation is accurate, and this observation is observed visually, which means that the height at which these things were observed and the way they were descended and the amount of time that has lapsed during this descent is consistent with what really happened, at least close to them. No data is available other than the media reports on this one. So please take it with a grain of salt. But the purpose of this exercise is to show that, you know, when we have the data, we can use the known physical aspects that we learned and derive the characteristics of some characteristics of these UAP. Now, what are they? If you go to the next slide. Because the reports indicated that they have descended rapidly from several thousand feet to the sea level, we can estimate what could be the possible time of descent regarding these objects when they are falling under the influence of gravity in an environment with atmospheric drag force acting as a resistance. These are aerial phenomena, so we can assume different shapes and their drag coefficients, we can consider the N member cases for these drag coefficients, which means that we can assume a large drag coefficient and see how things work out, and the small drag coefficient and see how things work out in terms of how much time it would take for a normal object that we are familiar with these different shapes, and see how much time they would need to descend from height, whatever the height they were reported from. The reported heights may not also be accurate. I've heard that they may not be as high as they were reported in the papers, but you'll see shortly that it doesn't matter, even if they are at half the height of the reported heights in the papers. Next slide, please. All right, so this is just the couple of equations I used to calculate the free fall time velocity, and based on the terminal velocity of these objects and the drag coefficients. I assume some drag
Ravi, I'm afraid you've frozen. Thank you.
I'm sorry. How long was that?
You froze for the last minute.
Oh.
So you may want to repeat what you were expecting to say.
Oh, sorry. Okay. My internet. All right. So I just wanted to say that I used free fall time velocity and terminal velocity expressions to derive how fast these objects descended, assuming some type of mass for these consistent with the commercial airlines or even fighter jets, and drag coefficients and the area of these objects. So can we go to the next slide, please? All right, so here it is. So if we assume some mass and range of masses and range of areas, I'm not going to stick to one single value of mass and areas. What I'm showing here on the x-axis is the amount of mass that you can consider for these objects, and the y-axis, the area of these objects. The colored, different colored curves, regions are the free fall time descents in seconds. So the bluest ones are the very short time scales, and the yellow and orange ones towards the left top are the long time scales. And so you can see the scales actually, the color scale here go on the color palette on the right, the vertical bar goes up to 60 seconds or so. And what I have made this on this plotted on this plot also is how much time would it take a commercial airline to free fall under the influence of gravity, assume this drag coefficient. And you can see where that lies in this region. It takes about a minute or so, more than a minute actually, assuming different kinds of drag coefficients. And if you go to the next slide, the reported time of descent for the objects that have been observed in this UAP, at least the ones reported in the newspapers, they're off the plot. They were a couple of seconds or even less. And so I can't even plot them on this plot. So if you go to the next slide, let's say we change the drag coefficient even a little bit to maximize or take the N member cases. Even then, you can see the blue colored areas are the shortest time descent times, and the orange and yellow ones are the longest ones. And the commercial airline free fall times is indicated by that oval on the plot. Again, these are at least a couple of minutes, but with the amount of drag coefficient that we know of. Okay, so these are again the time of descent. Observed time of descent seem to have been fraction of a second or a couple of seconds. Again, off the plot of this curve. Can we go to the next slide, please? Okay, so how do we compare this with the descent time of the New Shepard Blue Origin? Spacecraft that was launched a couple of weeks ago, that if we look at the descent time from 60,000 feet in zero gravity the difference of 60,000 feet from that height in zero gravity, it takes about 60 seconds roughly. So even, yep, thank you. Can we go to the next slide? So, right. So the acceleration and thrust seem to be in several hundreds of Gs, and so they are enormous. That we can consider. Again, I want to give a caveat here that these are all based on the published reported in the media, and we do not have the data. It would be greatly help us in doing this analysis properly if we have the data available. Next slide, please. All right, so here is my conclusion once, and I want these to be the take-home points. Science progresses without stigma, right? So no single explanation for all UAP events. We should have the scientific analysis done on these, having the data available. We need multidisciplinary scientists, engineers, instrumentalists. This is an aerospace problem. Each expertise is very valuable. No single person is an expert in all of the things. So we need help from other disciplines as well. These are transient events. As an example, to observe the ones that I just talked about, to determine the altitude, we need radar observations that could provide the speed, altitude, and size of these objects. If not radar, we need a 3D projection of these ones. So we need some sort of imaging on this. Fast track cameras probably might be suited for these transient events. Telescopes, this is not an astronomical phenomenon. So telescopes are probably not relevant, but we'll discuss this later. This is the last point I would like to make. Every object must follow laws of thermodynamics. They must emit waste heat. Which part of the electromagnetic spectrum that the heat is emitted is a question. So longer wavelength observations are likely needed if we want to know the observed characteristics, some of the observed characteristics of this UAP. Thank you. I think I'll stop over here.
Right on time, Ravi. Thank you.
Thank you.
I also now will enter into our 5 minute question answer. So from the audience, please ask your questions to Ravi directly.
Can I address Kevin's question or comment in the chat?
Sure, Ravi, please.
Yes, Kevin, yes, you're right. That's why I mentioned the caveat that some of the reported heights for these descent are probably not accurate. So I actually did an analysis, even assuming they are at 28,000 feet, because we had a conversation, right? So it didn't matter. Even then, it would take 40 seconds or something, 40, 45 seconds. To do the free fall. So you're right that they must be having that. I just can't explain this phenomena by free fall, because the amount of thrust you would need to reach within a couple seconds from that height, even from your 28,000 feet, I just do not know if these readings are right, if these reports are correct, and if everything I've done is accurate.
Yeah, we found, as I'll mention this in my upcoming talk, but we found that as these things had to accelerate and then decelerate, and that the minimum acceleration is on the order of 5,000 times the acceleration of gravity. It's the only way you're going to get in the ballpark of what was observed.
Yep, that's right.
Thank you.
Yep, thank you.
Other questions for Ravi, please.
Hi, this is Christopher Plain from The Debrief. Ravi, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Thank you.
Okay. I see at the bottom of this slide, it says every object must follow laws of thermodynamics. Is your research also considering atmospheric phenomena or maybe visual phenomena, something that may not be a physical object, and therefore would that also be constricted to those laws?
So the laws of thermodynamics apply everywhere, right? So if it's an atmospheric phenomenon, if it's a physical object, it has to have waste heat. But if it is not, and if it's not an atmospheric phenomenon, it must follow something else, some other, similar laws of thermodynamics. So it could be some an atmospheric phenomena that could, maybe we could figure out if we have enough data available on that.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Ravi, I have a question for you. He is René Nardi. I'm from New Jersey. The question is, on your charts, you have considered the drag coefficients 2, 1, but have you considered 0 as a drag coefficient?
So the reason why I did not consider 0 is because the lowest drag coefficient I could justify was this airfoil one. And
I agree with you 100%. Your approach is 100% correct. However, what if drag is zero? What happens? I don't know how to get to zero, but we should start asking weird questions. For example, you raise a great point. Heat must be there. It's just a matter of wavelength that we are not collecting information about heat signature. Just think about that. What if drag is zero?
Yes. So can I quickly answer that question if you go to the next slide? The next slide. Yes. Look at what happens if drag coefficient is zero in these equations. So CD is the drag coefficient. If it's zero, the terminal velocity becomes infinity. Or the descent time, final descent time would be instantaneous. For me, I do not know how an object, if it is an object at all, as someone pointed out just now, it may be Christopher, I think, pointed out, it may be an atmospheric phenomena or maybe anomalous reading in the instrument. If we assume that is an object, an actual object, I do not know how a physical object would have a zero drag coefficient and have an instantaneous time of descent with a terminal velocity reaching infinity. That is not how I know how it works from these equations, at least. But I need to have a physical motivation, is what I'm saying, that to consider a drag coefficient zero.
Okay, Robbie, thank you. I'll hold it there. That completes our time for the question answer for speaker associated. Robbie, thank you so much. And I'm going to stop share, going to another file, and we will get started with Kevin's presentation in just a second. All right, by way of introduction, the next presenter is Dr. Kevin Newt. He's the Associate Chair of Physics, as you can see the location at SUNY. Also, besides what's on the chart, he is the Editor-in-Chief of Entropy Journal, Editorial Board of Axioms Journal, amongst others. He also served as a research scientist in the Intelligent Systems Division at NASA Ames Research Center. His research areas are quantum mechanics and physics, relevance and maximum entropy, and a high quality Bayesian data analysis. And with that introduction, Kevin, I'll turn it over to you and look forward to what you have to say.
All right, thank you very much. Great, thank you very much for that kind introduction, and thank you for the organization as well. So my name's Kevin Knuth, and I did this work with my colleague, Professor Matthew Shadagas, also at SUNY Albany, and David Mason, an engineer who we're working with on the UAPX project. Next slide. So the scientific collection of data on UAPs is underway. We have the UAPX group, which was formed by Senior Chief Kevin Day, who you can see in the middle here. Senior Chief Kevin Day was on the USS Princeton in 2004 during the Nimitz encounters. He was the one who was actually tracking these things on radar. So we have a good team of people from the Navy and Air Force, along with physicists, and we've actually been active collecting data. Next slide, please. We all became aware of the ATIP program, the Advanced Aerospace Threat Identification Program, which was run by the Defense Intelligence Agency in 2017, in the New York Times article. And one of the useful outputs from that program is the list of the five observables. we have positive lift, sudden, or they call it instantaneous acceleration. I'll mention that in a bit. And hypersonic velocity without signatures, transmedium travel, and low observability or cloaking. So this talk is going to focus on these five observables, as well as some other physical characteristics that we've observed. Next slide, please. So I want to reinforce the understanding that the vast majority of UAP are misidentifications of astronomic and atmospheric phenomena or conventional aircraft. And another large proportion are hoaxes. That is not disputed here. It really comes down to only about 3% of reported UAP are of interest, and a subset of those appear to be anomalous unidentified aircraft, and these are the ones we're especially interested in. Next slide. So here's an example of mistaken identity. This was a photograph taken in Vancouver, and the object, the flying object in the photograph, was not seen by the photographer. This is very typical when this happens, and was seen only later. And it can be identified, next slide please, as a seagull. If you blow it up and compare it to seagulls, you'll notice this. I recognize this right away because I'm a lifelong bird watcher, so for me it was obvious it was a seagull. Maybe not obvious to everyone. Next slide, please. Also, some images are altered. Here's an image of a purported image of a UAP, triangular shaped or boomerang shaped UAP. As an astronomer, I recognized immediately that the stars are not real. And you can then hypothesize as to what else might not be real in this image. So we don't need to go into details. Next slide, please. So some UAP have been partially identified, and I'll use that phrase, partially identified as structured craft. That means we have descriptions of the object, sometimes detailed descriptions, and but we don't have any frame of reference with which to compare them. And these are the cases that are of extreme interest to us. Next slide. And so now I'll go into the five observables and other physical observables, looking at some examples. Next slide. So positive lift is the first one. And on the right here, you see a video, a short clip from a video taken by US Homeland Security in Aguadilla, Puerto Rico in 2013. So you have this object that flew over the airfield in Aguadilla and then headed out over the ocean and eventually went into the water. The object was estimated in size after by analysis was performed by the people at SCU, the Scientific Coalition for UAP Studies, and you'll hear from Peter Reale on another case coming up. The object was small, a small football-shaped object. The important points here scientifically are there are no apparent lift or control surfaces. It's unknown how lift was generated in this case, and unknown how the object propelled itself. Objects like this, UAP, have been observed to be capable of flying and or hovering for long periods of time. When chased by jets, there are many examples where jets have chased these objects and run low on fuel and had to go back and refuel or replace, send up another jet instead. So the two well-known cases are the 1952 UFOs over Washington, D.C., and in 1956 over Lake and Heath. And Ravi had just asked if I could show the previous slide. Can you go back to the previous slide quickly? There. I don't think I had any information there. Okay, go to the next slide. Thank you. And next. There we are. Yeah, so, the last point on the previous slide was there's no heat signature. That imagery is from an infrared camera, and you don't see any heat signature from the engines or exhaust. All right, next slide, please. So another one of the five observables is sudden or instantaneous acceleration. By instantaneous, what they mean is that it's too high to measure. So the ATIP program talks about accelerations that are too high to measure. And we've looked at several cases and published them in this peer-reviewed paper that's linked to down below. And the accelerations we've estimated in those cases range from 70 G to over 5,000 G. Now the case here that I've illustrated on the right is the one that Ravi was talking about from the Washington Post. Unfortunately, the newspapers mess up the numbers. The objects were tic-tac-shaped objects, which were traveling horizontally at about 120 knots and would suddenly drop from about 28,000 feet to 0 feet sea level or 50 feet above sea level. There were various instances of this, and that would happen on the order of 0.78 seconds. So if you treat this as, if you want to estimate the minimal acceleration to pull this off, you would accelerate at some acceleration A halfway and then decelerate at the same acceleration the other half of the way. And that allows you to estimate the minimum acceleration observed here. And in this case, you can see from this histogram, we've accounted for uncertainties. So the height was 28,000 plus or minus 300 feet. And we put some uncertainty into the time as well. So we have a distribution. And you can look at the research paper to get more details on that. But you can see it's unavoidable for these accelerations to be less than 1,000 G. And 1,000 G is, as I'm sure you were all aware, absolutely insane. So what's going on here is truly anomalous. All right, next slide, please. So another characteristic, one of the five observables, is hypersonic velocity without signatures. And by that, there's no sonic booms. There's no air disturbances that you would expect from hypersonic speeds. So UFOs have been, UAPs, sorry, I'm using old terminology, have been tracked at hypersonic speeds in air, hypersonic speeds as high as Mach 55, which is about 42,500 miles an hour, were reported by Hermann Oberth, the rocketry pioneer, in a lecture he gave on UFOs back in 1954. When in estimating this case, we found that if you accelerate at 5,000 G down and then decelerate 5,000 G, at the midpoint, you are traveling about 46,000 miles an hour, Mach 60. This is faster, or on the order of the speed of the New Horizons spacecraft that recently flew past Pluto. Not so recently, 6 years ago, I guess now. So one may ask, why do people mistake these objects as spacecraft? Why do people hypothesize that these things are spacecraft? And the answer is quite simple. These things are moving as fast as spacecraft move. So the New Horizons probe was one of our fastest probes ever. And these tic-tac objects had to be moving at least those speeds to be able to perform the maneuvers that we see. Now, what's shocking about this, even more shocking, is the fact that there's no energy deposition when these things decelerate or stop. So this drop maneuver, we assumed that the object had a mass of 1,000 kilograms, just to pull some number out. It's about the same size as an F-18. So an F-18 is about 1,500 kilograms. Or over 15,000 kilograms. So we thought we'll go an order of magnitude less than that, about 1,000. And performing that maneuver, the amount of energy that would have been necessary would have been on the order of 4 times 10 to the 11th joules. So that's equivalent to 100 tons of TNT, or would have been equivalent to blowing up 250 cruise missiles, Tomahawk cruise missiles simultaneously. There should have been a huge explosion when this thing came to a stop at the sea surface. And that was not observed. Hermann Oberth, and a little bit's cut off at the bottom here because of Zoom, he wrote, their speed is sometimes very high. 19 kilometers per second has been measured with wireless measuring instruments, radar. Accelerations are so high that no man could stand it. He would be pressed against the wall and bruised. I would say that it would be worse than that, far worse. The accuracy of such measurements has been doubted. If there would only be 3 or 4 measurements, I would not reply upon them and would wait for further measurements. But there is existing more than 50 such measurements. the wireless sets or radar of the American Air Force and Navy, which are used in all fighters and cannot be so inaccurate that the information obtained, blah, blah, blah. You get the idea. So that's from Herman Oberst's talk in 1954. And it's a shame that 60 years ago, we knew this much and still did not proceed as the, in the scientific community to study these things. That's 60 years of research lost. Next slide, please. Transmedium travel. UAPs can travel effortlessly in multiple media, from air to water, as you can see illustrated here on the video on the upper right. This is again the Aguadilla, Puerto Rico case, and this is after it's headed out to sea, and you can watch the object will actually travel underwater. The graph below is from the report produced by SCU, the Scientific Coalition for UAP Studies, and they show that the object enters the water around 110 miles an hour, and once it's submerged, it's traveling at about 100 miles an hour. Those are their estimates. So you, and then continues through the water around 85 miles an hour. So you don't have a very dramatic speed decrease as this object enters the water. I mentioned here space and vacuum. The senior chief Kevin Day on the USS Princeton said that the radar operators who are there for tracking missiles coming in from space, like intercontinental ballistic missiles, had tracked these UAPs coming in from low Earth orbit before they got to the 80,000 feet that his radar was able to pick them up at. So, but none of those radar operators have come forward to talk about what they observed. So I have that in red. And then I asked the question, you know, these things have moved from air to water effortlessly. Can they move through solids? There are almost literally a handful of cases where people claim to observe this, although nothing definite. Next slide, please. All right, low observability or cloaking. So this is the same object in Aguadilla, and you watch as it's flying over the city here, it'll actually dramatically change size and almost disappear at some points. So it's not clear exactly what's going on, but the UAP are observed to do that. Sometimes this activity seems to be intentional, as if they're trying to hide, and sometimes it just seems to happen. Next slide, please. Another effect is a plasma sheath. UFOs or UAPs are sometimes surrounded by what appears to be a plasma sheath, a glowing plasma around the object. It's often one source of the emitted light from these objects. The plasma and heat would tend to make images blurry, and so very often UAP imagery is blurry. Also, not everyone is a great photographer and able to photograph under, you know, stressful conditions like this. So here in the upper picture in the upper right, I have a picture from the US Navy gimbal video, and you can see the object there. And I'm comparing it to another image that was taken by Ray Stanford back in 1985. And this was a multi-witness event from Corpus Christi, Texas, where several of these objects were, they're disc-shaped objects, were seen to be moving across the screen or across the sky. And he filmed this with a Super 8 camera. I want to be clear that that imagery here has not been independently vetted. So we've not taken that to be authenticated. And so I want to be clear and honest about that. Although I have talked to people who have seen it and seen it in person. And Christian Lambright is one such person who was able to view the video or the movie just a few months after it was recorded. So we found that this is really interesting, first because it demonstrates the plasma sheath. You can see this blue glow around the metallic object. The shape of the plasma sheath is interesting because it looks very similar to what you see in the gimbal video. And one other feature here is if you look at the blue picture in the lower right, you'll see the cone-shaped object. So it's a disc-shaped metal disc with a blue plasma plasma glow around it. And around the point of that plasma glow, you'll see a thin line of a thin blue line coming off of it to the right. Hopefully that shows up on Zoom. And I'll mention that on the next slide, please. So one way, one technique now used to achieve hypersonic speeds in air is to use a laser beam to basically create plasma in front of the craft, and the plasma creates a shockwave that actually goes around the vehicle, and this allows the vehicle to plow through the air at higher speeds. So this is a technique that's currently being worked on. And next screen, next slide. And this is what appears to be happening here. And in fact, this is what Ray Stanford claimed he saw, is that he saw the plasma beam would come out from the plasma glow around the disk, and then the disk would fly forward toward the beam. What was interesting is that he notes that the disks that he's observed fly basically, they hover like this, like you would expect in an aerodynamic fashion, but when they're ready to fly, they actually tip up and fly bottom forward, which is not what you would expect. You would expect it to fly in the most aerodynamic way possible. What's interesting is that Herman Oberth mentions this as well in his 1954 presentation. He writes, the disks always fly in a manner as if the drive is acting perpendicular to the plane of the disk. When they're suspended over certain terrain, they keep horizontal. And when they want to fly very quick, they tilt and fly with the plane directed forward, and so on. So next slide, please. And back to low observability, and we're still on low observability and cloaking. In addition to fading away and disappearing, changing size, these objects are often appeared to split into multiple objects. So you can see in the sequence of imagery that I got from the Aguadilla video, down by the bottom, it appears that you actually have two objects. This, of course, now in some cases, this can happen very rapidly in many multiple images a second, so the object can look blurry. This also contributes to blurred photographs. And so if you take photographs, you want to photograph at a very high speed.
2 minutes.
Thank you. Next slide, please. So here's another example of multi-imaging where the object appears to break into two. And sometimes these multiple images can be at different orientations or different views of the object. And so it can be a subtle effect or very dramatic, as in this video here from the Puerto Rico. All right, next slide, please. Also, sometimes you get a volume around the object in which the background imagery appears distorted. So I'll call that a distortion field. And you can see that here, especially when this object flies over the lines designating parking spaces. And the question would be raised, you know, is this optical refraction due to a varying index of refraction? Or do you have distortion in lensing due to a gravitational field? These are two hypotheses. There are probably more hypotheses one could come up with. And next slide. Another physical effect is low temperature. As Ravi noted in his talk, you would expect these objects to generate waste heat, and they very often do not. And so this is very surprising. This is a go fast video, and the object may not be going very fast. It's been, as has been claimed, it's called go fast because it looks like it's going fast, right? That's probably the most impressive thing about the video. However, what's interesting is if you look in the lower left corner, you'll see the letters BLK at the bottom. That means hot objects are black. This UAP is cold. It's white and it's cold. It's colder than the sea surface. So we've got a cold object that's basically cruising along the sea surface. So not a seagull. Seagulls are warm-blooded, warmer than the sea. This is a cold object, and it's not clear how that happens. And we find that in videos often. Next slide, please. This is a video that our engineer, David Mason, took. Then the And this was a jet airplane flying over that was hot. This is a UAP that's following it. We actually captured it in two cameras. So you're seeing both cameras here. Only one camera captured the jet airplane. So the UAP that's traveling has a temperature of about negative 60 Fahrenheit. So it's very cold and it appears to be a trefoil shape. It appears to be three distinct objects. So it could actually be three objects flying in formation. So this again, the bright object is warm. It's a jet airplane. And the object following it is about 60 degrees below zero.
Kevin, so time's up.
Okay, thank you. Next slide, please. I'm wrapping up. And we'll go next slide. Yeah, so one last really quick point is there have been some work on developing warp drives, some theoretical work. On the right, the diagram from the paper by Bo Brickman Martyr shows the space-time structure around their hypothetical warp drive. And just coincidentally, it looks very similar to the gimbal video and the Ray Stanford picture. All right, next slide, please. And next slide, there's strong magnetic fields and conclusions. So thank you very much for the talk. These objects are sincerely anomalous. They are interesting. They exhibit numerous observable physical effects. It is possible to observe these things. Our UAPX group is actively studying them and collecting, and we're actually analyzing data at this point from a recent trip we took to Southern California to collect data on these things. So please visit our site at uapexpedition.org. And if you're feeling generous, we're accepting donations. So thank you.
All right, Kevin, thank you. We'll open it up to a little bit shorter than 5 minutes for question and answer. So let me turn it over for someone who would like to ask Kevin a question from the information he just showed.
Hi, Kevin. It's Chris from the Debrief, head science writer from the Debrief. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can. Thank you.
Okay. Near the end of your presentation, there was a side-by-side video of infrared footage of a commercial airliner or a military airliner. And then
that was a commercial airliner. Yep.
What was the origin of that video?
David Mason from our UAPX group recorded that from his backyard in Renton, Washington.
Okay. Thank you. That was my main question.
Thank you. It's one of the many videos that we've recorded at this point with the UAPX group.
Are there plans to make those videos public, Kevin?
Yes. After we've analyzed them and hopefully published some of the data, we'll be making them public, certainly.
Great. Thank you. Well, if no one's going to ask another question, Kevin, I did have one in the side chat there.
Oh, sure. I didn't get a chance to look at this chat.
If a balloon could be colder than the sea surface on the GoFast video?
That's a good question. I'm not sure exactly if that would be reasonable. You would imagine that the sun hitting the balloon is going to heat up the rubber on the balloon and hence the air inside. So I can't imagine it being... It's not going to be less than the temperature of the air around it. At the very least, it would be at equilibrium. So you would have them be equal to temperatures. And if the sun is striking it, it's going to be warmer.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Kevin, I'll ask a question.
Sure. Thank you.
On the chart that you had, which showed the object changing shape.
Right.
This may be what I call Soto's statement of the obvious, but I'm going to assume that the origin of the object that was tracking that object stayed in the same relative distance, so there was not an effect of close up, far away. Would that be a correct statement?
Yeah, I think that's correct. Over the time scale that the object changes shape, I think it was being filmed from a helicopter. That was not dramatically changing its perspective. It was sufficiently distant.
Thank you. Other questions for Kevin?
Hi. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, Matthew.
Matthew Phelan. I'm working on a podcast on this topic for iHeartRadio. Kevin Knuth has dealt with me in the past.
Yep.
So I had a question about the issue of some of these speeds and accelerations being, you know, essentially too high to measure, and the what I'd love to hear more of your thoughts on the threshold there. You know, essentially you have something like radar, you know, that is pushing out EMF and getting EMF spectra back. And to what extent, when does it start to fall apart in terms of we can no longer even say with certainty that it is the same object? It could be like two like heated balls of plasma being produced by some electronic warfare. This is very hypothetical. I'm sorry, but
we have about 1 minute.
Okay, so I yield. You know, that's the gist of the question.
No, that's a good question. It's a good question. And I don't think it's clear at this point. And many of these cases are very different. Some of those objects that we looked at in our paper were observed to be one of them by Graham Bethune in 1951. We looked at the accelerations there, and that object was observed to be disc-shaped and about 300 feet in diameter. So they're very different than what you'd expect from a ball of plasma.
Thank you.
All right, Kevin, thank you so much.
All right, thank you.
We'll get out of share and go on to our next speaker. So give me 1 second, please. Okay, and I thank everybody for your patience. Our next speaker is Peter Rialli. Peter is a board member of the Scientific Coalition of UAP Studies. He's a retired electrical design engineer and manager from Silicon Valley. At Silicon Valley, his specialty was in telecommunications, information technologies, where he designed network communication systems, fiber optic ring networks, and timing synchronization. Further, he earned his bachelor's and master's in electrical engineering from the University of California, Berkeley. So, Peter, I'd like to turn it over to you.
Well, thank you. I want to thank the AIAA for having us here today for this important event. As I said, my name is Peter Rialli. I'm with the Scientific Coalition of UAP Studies, which is, been in existence for a few years now. And we're dedicated to trying to put a scientific basis on understanding these phenomena. So next slide. Since you've already introduced me, I'll just go to the next slide. Okay, I'm going to be talking today about the Nimitz event, which has been covered a little bit already before. The Nimitz event in 2004 is probably one of the best documented cases. It's been six pilots and two very qualified radar operators have testified that this is a valid event that really happened. So I'll be talking more about them later. Next slide. Okay, so the background on this was there was going to be a naval exercise in 2004 with the aircraft carrier USS Nimitz and its surrounding ships. And these objects had been observed for a few days before the actual exercise by Kevin Day, who's already been mentioned here. He was a chief he was in charge of the radar, and the objects were descending from 80,000 feet to 28,000, and then from 28 down to the surface, and going very, very erratic behavior. And there were groups of them, so the exercise was canceled, And, you know, the radar had been calibrated for a few days before. They'd been calibrating it many times. And this is a very advanced radar, spy one radar, you know, phased array radar, top, very, very state of the art at the time. Next slide. Okay, the methods we use as a forensic analysis, we the SCU was investigating this case a year before it came out in the New York Times. And we've interviewed several of the people involved in it. We've done FOIA studies. You know, we also have done a lot of kinematic analysis based on the reported measurements that were taken. And we do a statistical analysis, a null hypothesis, which is, and basically what we're trying to show is try and prove that this is a misidentified conventional object using conventional physics. That's the approach. And if we can't do that, then it has to be anomalous. So next slide. There were three basic encounters in this particular Nimitz event. The first encounter was by the radar operators, David Day and Gary Voris, which was we already talked about. The second was when the actual event was canceled, the exercise, they sent out two planes by David Fravor was the commander of them, and he actually descended down and got a close-up of the object, and that's where the tic-tac visualization has come from. The third was after they returned to the Nimitz aircraft carrier, they sent up another plane with two pilots, and they, with a flare camera, which is their video camera, it's an infrared camera, a targeting pod, they actually captured a video of the object. And that was done by, recently came out, the pilot has testified to a Chad Underwood. Next slide, please. Okay, we used two kinematic analysis from basic physics. Assuming, as mentioned before, the objects would hover at either high altitude or at sea level. They would then rocket up to a halfway point and then start decreasing their velocity to hover at the other point. And so we assume two kinematic analysis here, one for a linear velocity, and next slide, the other for a parabolic velocity, because at the center point, the halfway point for the linear velocity, there would be a huge acceleration change. So it was trying to make it, how could we make this so you could do this with a rocket engine in conventional physics? And it turns out that the, you know, it doesn't make a lot of difference. You trade one thing for another. Next slide. We also calculated the power requirements for this based on conventional Newtonian physics, basically force times velocity. And since we had the calculated velocities and accelerations, and we assume in this case, we don't know the mass of the object. We assume very conservative mass of 1 ton. And whereas like an F-18 airplane, which could have probably been the only other plane that could have been in the vicinity during this exercise because it's a restricted area, weighs 16 tons unfueled. So that we did a very, some kind of advanced conventional technology of 1 ton. Next slide, please. The results were, again, these amazing, you know, unbelievable velocities, accelerations, and power. So because it was said to, you know, it was 0.78 seconds for it to descend, we took a, you know, a devil's advocate and said, well, what if it's 6 seconds, you know, was mistaken or something like that. The net result is that for the 6 seconds, the most very conservative is that the velocity was between 16,600 miles per hour and 10,227 miles per hour. For the 0.78 seconds, it was 104,895 miles per hour to 78,409 miles per hour. For the acceleration was, for the 6 second was between 204 Gs to 310 Gs. And for the 0.78 seconds, it's 12,250 Gs to 18,385 Gs, depending on, of course, the assumed kinematics of it, assumed, you know, how the thing was accelerating, which we don't know, but we know what the averages are. So we can assume these two different trajectories. The power is just phenomenal. That's the to my mind, the most anomalous thing about it is the power, because there's no conservation of energy says this must be released to the atmosphere. Yet the power for the most conservative 6-second case varied between 11.3 gigawatts and 9.75 gigawatts. Now, to put this in perspective, a gigawatt is a good size nuclear power station. Maybe 1 to 1.5 gigawatts is what they produce. So this would be 11 of them. And for the linear case, it's phenomenal. It's 5,126 gigawatts or 4,440 gigawatts. This is equivalent to about a 1.05 kiloton of TNT being detonated per second, like a small tactical nuclear weapon. Next slide. The conclusions are no human could sustain the calculated 170 pound human would be subjected to a force of 17.6 to 1,041 tons. It would kill anybody. A 6-second parabolic trajectory is equivalent to 2.3 tons of TNT being detonated each second. The 0.78 second parabolic trajectory is equivalent to a 1.05 kiloton tactical nuclear weapon being detonated each second. And again, there was no report of any disturbance in the atmosphere. So the speed at maximum velocity would be equivalent to a meteorite entering the atmosphere from outer space. None of these effects were noticed by the personnel reporting this incident. Next slide, please. Okay, the second incident is one of the most interesting, and that is when David Fravor, commander, he's the commander of a flight wing, a squadron, I think, flight squad is the right term. And that was David Fravor, Jim Slate, and Lieutenant Commander Alex Dietrich, and one of their pilots who wishes to remain anonymous. All these people said this happened. They flew out from the exercise off the coast of Baja California in 2004. And when it was canceled, his two planes were sent out to investigate the radar images about 40 miles away from their cap point, which was the cap point is the terminology for where they do their exercise. They fly against one another and practice. They were going to be heading over to the Middle East for their deployment. They flew out to 40 miles out and at 40 miles out, David Fravor was alerted down below on the water was this white disturbance on the water, and he noticed this object bouncing around. So he decided to descend and keep the other plane up above. He descended down to about 8,000 to 10,000 feet. And at that point, the object, he could see the object was this tubular object, and it sort of noticed him and it moved out in an opposite direction. So he decided to cross and intercept the object. When he started crossing over to intercept the object shot off and described as like shot from a gun. So that there was no timing except shot from a gun, which means usually you can't see it. A few short time later, the radar operators said that the object was back at the cap point. So it had traveled 40 miles horizontally and vertically, also with a vertical altitude probably of 10,000 feet in a very short amount of time, in its seconds, perhaps. Next slide. So this is how it was described. This is from a video by Dave Beatty. It's like a natural gas tank with some appendages on the bottom. Next slide, please. Now, shooting out of sight could be due to two things, and we took those into account. One is it shot over the horizon. The second one was visual acuity of the eyesight. Now, good eyesight, you can see 1/60th of a degree, a 1 arc minute. And after that, you can't really begin to recognize it. And also the object is described between 56 to 60 feet long. And what we did is this thing could have been traveling at different angles. So we considered 60 feet, 30 feet, 50 feet, because it could be observed in different aspect ratios. Also, we considered calculations for between very good vision of 1/60th of a degree down to 1/50th of a degree. And so next slide. So for the over the horizon, it's very easy to calculate the horizon is at different altitudes. We found that can't be the case because at 10 to 8,000 feet, the horizon is more than 100 miles away. And the object showed up at the 40-mile distance. So next slide. So for the visual acuity, we took all those factors into account using a little bit of trigonometry. We could calculate the distance and the time required. Since shot from a gun is a little bit nebulous, we calculated for a series of different times, 0.2 seconds, 0.5 seconds, 2.5 and 5 seconds. And I'll talk about 0.5 and 5 seconds. The reason is 0.5 seconds from psychological studies is about the time you can notice, it takes for the brain to notice changes in perception. It's been measured. And 5 seconds is nobody can really say, 5 seconds probably at the limit that you would say something shot from a gun. So next slide. What we got for that calculation was another more astounding characteristics. For the half second, which is the shot from a gun, the maximum accelerations varied from 83,400 G's to 3,202 G's, and the for the not shot from a gun, the 5 second one, it varied from 834 G's to 32 G's. All of these would destroy an airplane. For the power, maximum power for the shot from a gun was 1.71 times 10 to the fifth gigawatts. And I'm assuming a one, we're here, we're assuming a one ton mass. Oh, it's weight, but you convert it to mass. And so we get 1.71 times 10 to the fifth gigawatts. And remember, a gigawatt is a nuclear power station. And for the minimum, 1,290 gigawatts. For the not shot from a gun, it varies from 171 gigawatts to 1.29 gigawatts, all anomalous. So next slide. So the final conclusions are the blind point distance wasn't determined to be due to visual acuity. Looking at the acceleration in all cases would be intolerable to human pilots. In most likely cases, any mechanically complicated mechanism would disintegrate due to the excessive forces. Certainly any airplane would not survive. The power dissipated of any known type of heat engine would have caused noticeable, highly visible effects to the next strike group, due to conservation of energy. That kind of energy has to go somewhere. Five, the only component of velocity and acceleration considered was the horizontal trajectory. In the first case, we considered the vertical, so you'd have to add that as well, so there'd be even more energy. We're just trying to do the simple calculations that show the anomalous effect. The null hypothesis event that this event is explained by known objects that were misidentified can't be substantiated. So the objects remain unknown of unknown origin and technology. Next slide, please. The third one is the encounter by Chad Underwood, where he with his flare camera, his targeting pod, got a video of it. He did not see the object. He was far enough away, but he caught it on his flare camera, and it was doing the same behaviors as described. He has recently come out and done a video and several interviews talking about this. He remained quiet for quite a few years until this all became public, and then he finally came out. And this shows a targeting pod which mounts under the plane on the left. On the right is the screen that the pilots see with the metadata and an example of, we had to study the metadata to understand what the different parts are. A lot of this is not very easy to do because much of this is classified. Further, an important point that is often left out about this is when these objects were viewed, they were using a narrow field of view, which is about 0.7 angular degrees. And this is equivalent to a telescope of about 80 power, 100 power. So they can see objects miles away. And you know, this has been testified by multiple pilots. So next slide, please. Here's an example of what you would see of, these are stealth aircraft, the F-35 and the B-2 bomber. You can see in infrared, they're not invisible. They're invisible radar, or pretty much invisible radar, not perfect, but you know, very hard to detect. And you can clearly see the outlines. You can because as the objects move through the atmosphere, they're heated. And so in this case, white is hotter than the background. And so you can actually see on the left, the F-35, you can see the exhaust coming out of its tail and its characteristics of it. And so this is with the infrared characteristics. Next slide, please. Now, this is how we calculated the trajectory based on this. Since on the left is the sensor, or we could also be used like a human eyeball. And we know the field of view of the camera. And we also know the estimated size of the object. So using trigonometry, you can estimate for different distances and the same size object, you can actually estimate the field of view that the object travels through. And on the screen, we divide the object into 12 reticles, 12 divisions. The object takes up a certain amount of space on this. And so you can calculate if you know the timing, which I'll talk about next, you can actually calculate the speed and acceleration. We again use the linear, and in this case, we use basically the linear velocity approach because we know the averages, and it's just a convenient way to treat it because we don't know the real trajectory, but it has to be something on this order of magnitude. Next slide.
10 minutes.
Next slide. Okay, in this case, this shows the framing. With the framing, we can determine the timing of how the object moves through the object through the screen and get the timing for the object. Next slide, please. In this case, we have two things to deal with here. The size of the object viewed on the screen, it has a dense center and then a corona around it. So we had to deal with two sizes, the two diameters. We did calculations for both. The second was a complication. As it moves to the left, the pilot increased the zoom. So during the X2 portion of the screen, the distances have to be halved. And next slide. The net result is these graphs are for what we call early zoom, late zoom. I won't talk about the late zoom because it's really unrealistic. It was done just to emphasize, just to have a sort of a devil's advocate against it. The realistic and most conservative is the early zoom case. And the plane flies at the object flies at 30 to 110 Gs. Next slide. In this case, the power requirement, you can calculate the available power of an F-18, which is the only plane possible in the area. And it's also similar to probably even any other kind of advanced jet. And it only had 1 to 34% of the needed power to perform the observed accelerations. The same with the late zoom, even less, 0.8 to 4.5%. So it can't, next slide. Okay, so here's the conclusions. The Tic Tacs are not aircraft of any known type, exhibit technological capability beyond anything that existed in 2004 or that exists today. Tic Tacs exhibit at least one of the following characteristics. No aerodynamic airframe, no obvious means of reactive propulsion, acceleration characteristics beyond human endurance and airframe structured capability. If the apparent movement of the left is due to vibration of the airplane, well, basically what this is saying is that the only reason you can lose lock is through excessive acceleration to the left. The fourth one is Tic Tacs were a missile. It would be smaller and closer to the plane, and it would not have acceleration calculated in the flare display as shown above. Next slide. The Tic Tacs were a missile or an airplane. As it moved left, it would have to bank, the plane would bank and the missile would show its longer edge and the diameter of the image of the flare display would move left, and it does not happen. If the Tic Tacs were F-18 size aircraft, it would be between 18 and 33 miles from the flare camera. And with this telescopic capability, it would be capable of identifying it by its shape, or certainly by the external dimensions of the image on the screen. The size would be able to be calculated, and we'd have shown above. 7, the Tic Tacs demonstrate accelerations greater than 40 Gs and most likely much higher, with no noticeable effect on their structure or performance. Here we are using the early zoom figures from table 1 as the most conservative. 8, the flare is capable of registering the maximum dimensions of aircraft airframes and showing that the aircraft structures that support lift and maneuver functions are none are observed. There's no lift capability. 9, the F-18 does not have adequate power to exhibit even the minimal required acceleration for maneuvers that are observed in the video. And I think I'll stop here.
All right, Peter, thank you. We have about roughly 3.5 minutes for questions. So please, anyone, go ahead and for Peter.
Peter, I'm sorry, go ahead. I have a question. It's Philip Iris talking. Peter, just a question. If you would have to ask the military some related data, which ones would you consider studying? The radar data as a first priority or something else?
I had a little trouble understanding what your question is. I'm sorry.
Yeah, if you would... if it would be possible for you to ask military the data for the military, what kind of data would be the first objective? Like the radar data would be the most important to study?
What's the most important data to study?
Yes.
We'd like to have the radar. We'd like to have radar and we'd actually like to have, you know, this is only a small part of the videos that were taken, and we'd like to have a whole video, you know, and see, you know, many of these things, we only get little snippets of it. And there's, so we'd like to have radar and any kind of RF measurements they have, but basically any of the data, you know, that. It all's just, you know, we have almost nothing. You know, we have to scrounge around to get anything, you know, and that's basically about all I can say.
Thanks, Peter.
All right, Peter, I was going to be asking you just from the point of view of this, would you consider that in a generic sense, one of your greatest challenges for what you're doing?
Yes, the inability to have the hard data to get and the, not having the data to analyze is very difficult. We have to you go to extreme measures and we have to make assumptions that if we had the data, we wouldn't have to make. And they're good assumptions, you know, but they don't really dial into the actually what's going on. You know, they're very broad. And they just show that things are anomalous, but we'd like to have more detail on this. And most of this stuff is classified, but they could be released. This data could be released and scrub the classification part of it and just give us the data. You know, how you got the data is not, details about your instrument and stuff and is not so as important. Although perhaps some of the giving away some of this stuff might reveal some secrets, but this was 2004. This data was 2004, so they've made things advanced quite a bit. So you could I'm sure that by this time it's not that classified. But once things get classified, it's very difficult to overcome that.
All right, Peter, thank you. And with that, that'll conclude our first portion of our three speakers that covered the technical characteristics of UAP. We'll engage now into a 10-minute break and then pick up with our next set of speakers, which will be covering the safety implications of UAP. The break will be approximately 10 minutes now, 10 minutes, and we'll be starting now. Thank you. All right, everybody, welcome back. I will pick up now for the second part. And again, welcome to all that are here for this special panel session advocating for scientific study of unidentified aerial phenomenon, technical perspective with focus on aviation safety. Now we come to our second half of speakers, which will be emphasizing and discussing safety implications of the UAP. So it is my pleasure to introduce Ryan Graves, who's a lieutenant in the United States Navy, who served for over 10 years, specifically also as a naval aviator, FA-18F as in Foxtrot pilot. Right now, he's currently a principal investigator within research and development in the aerospace defense industry. And with that, let me turn it over to you, Ryan, and look forward to what you have to say.
Thank you so much. And thank you for having me. This is great to be here in front of you and be able to have this conversation in front of the people that I know, at least from the industry and my experience as an operator, are the ones that are going to be able to introduce technology that's going to be able to help us out. So just to kick things off here, you know, we have the most respect for the scientists and engineers that make some of the technology that we have the privilege to use. So it's an honor for me to speak to you all here. And this is certainly going to be a highlight. So thank you for being here. The title of my talk is Persistent Detection of Non-Participating Aircraft by United States Navy Tactical Aircraft. And you will notice the date 2014 to the present. Next slide, please. So for those that do not have a background, as stated, I was a FA-18 Foxtrot pilot attached to VFA-11, the Red Rippers. We were stationed in NAS Oceana. It's the Master East Coast Jet Base located in Virginia Beach, Virginia. Now, as a Navy pilot, we are training when we're in the United States. So we're not in an operational status. We don't necessarily carry weapons. What we are doing is going through our training so that when we deploy, we can act as an expeditionary force. But to prepare for those deployments, we operate in a number of working areas, one of those being off the coast of Virginia Beach, starting about 10 nautical miles off the coast, where it is not a restricted area, but it is a an area where we will maintain MARSA, which is when the military assumes responsibility for separation of aircraft. So we typically are in communication with everyone that is out there. We do have some assistance from controllers to give us a heads up if anyone is out there transiting that shouldn't be. One very important consideration is during this time period, we were one of the few squadrons that had the aircraft plumbed in order to upgrade our primary sensor, the APG 73. We were upgrading it to the APG 79, which was really a big change for us to go from the mechanically scanned array to the active, to the AESA radar. So a lot of capability. And for some of us, it wasn't our first time flying this aircraft. Utilizing this radar as we had used it during our training. But when we got to the fleet squadron, we were strictly an APG 73 squadron until this point. Additionally, we would often fly with the ANASQ 228 Advanced Targeting Forward-Looking Infrared Pod, which I will forevermore refer to as the FLIR. That is kind of our eyeball where we can receive standard camera vision or IR energy, depending on the mode we're selected in. And really how this story starts is that we start upgrading the radar while we're flying the area, and essentially we start picking up more things than we're used to. Next slide, please. All right, so once we started flying onto the areas, we started noticing some radar contacts that were in the confines of our working areas that did not appear to be respecting any of the area subdivision boundaries or even the primary boundaries outside of the airspace. They didn't seem to be playing by the same rules as us. A lot of them were stationary. Some of them were flying in some patterns that we'll discuss here later. And we're really seeing them wherever we are looking. So really from 35,000 feet down the surface, which is kind of our standard scan where I would typically look. So, you know, this is the airspace that we're typically operating in, and wherever we look, we were seeing them essentially. As I said, there's really two categories is how we surmise this, is that there were stationary ones. So, and that was indicated by relative velocity to the surface of the Earth, and then non-station ones that were moving around out there. As we were exclusively operating off of the East Coast and over the water, we did notice them over the water, so a bit of a selection bias, but, you know, turning back to the west or when operating over the land, you know, our radar is out in front of us, and we did not see them over land at this point. Next slide, please. Thank you. So the stationary objects were a bit peculiar in appearance on our sensors. So all was 0.0 Mach, as defined again, stationary over a ground point, regardless of winds. So remaining stationary against the winds in a very stable manner. Target aspect indicative of perhaps the computer didn't know how to read it, or perhaps rotation. So the blue circle with the line coming out of it represents what I would see on my system. And the straight line represents the target aspect of the contact. So where are they going? While this particular drawing down here shows a progression through three stages, that's what we'd see. We'd basically see a stationary object where the target aspect would, in a somewhat consistent manner, kind of rotate around the contact. So it kind of was almost as if it was kind of just banging around up there, or there was some uncertainty with the reading. So in that way, at least I was able to kind of look out and be like, oh, that's one of those particular things out there. And it was a way of identifying them and separating it from potentially other air contacts out there. Most air contacts are very smooth target aspect, and it's very clear, as you would expect. Next slide, please. The non-stationary behaviors really are mostly defined by the speed. So I would typically see them somewhere in the vicinity of 0.6 Mach to 0.8 Mach. And they would be proceeding either in a straight line east. I would see them in a racetrack pattern. And occasionally I'd see them just coming down, usually not aggressively fast, just coming down 1,000 to 4,000 feet. It is a very rough estimate. It didn't appear to me as if it was drifting down, I would say, but it was moving down with a decent of velocity. On a rare occasions, you know, we'd look out, or at least I would look out, and I would see them in the supersonic range, 1.1 to 1.2 Mach. Those were kind of the ones that I would typically see just kind of cruising east. They wouldn't be in a holding pattern at that airspeed when I did observe those. And one thing that's kind of peculiar here is that, you know, I very rarely would see them accelerate, you know, so I would very rarely see a stationary one that would be stationary. And while I watched it, it would just accelerate to 0.6 or whatever airspeed, 1.1. Very rarely see that, right? And it's an important thing to remember here that we're not out there looking for these things in particular, right? So we have very complex training missions and objectives that we're looking to accomplish. And so this is kind of a passing consideration. Of course, we'll talk about here shortly why that was a problem, but initially, we weren't considering them as a physical object. It was the real reason, but we came to respect them shortly afterwards. Next slide, please. All right. So the fact that they appeared stationary for the most part, and or were kind of moving at air speeds that we weren't expecting, they weren't expected to be there, right? So for one, we weren't expecting a number of these things to be here anytime, right? It's pretty much F-18s only out there. So to have a non-player out there was strange. But with the radar upgrade, our initial assessment initially was that It was some type of false track that was being provided by the radar. We were not seeing these on the APG-73. We just simply weren't picking them up. However, on the APG-73, you did sometimes get anomalous readings that could represent perhaps some atmospheric conditions that we were familiar with, and we would expect to see a false track or some reflections or some ground clutter or something to that effect. So we were familiar seeing stuff like this. And that was kind of our initial assessment, was that the APG-79, it must have some of those same issues that the 73 had, and perhaps it'll get worked out because we'll get some software upgrades. So at this point, again, it wasn't really a safety concern for us. It was a point of interest about our radar. Next slide, please. Eventually, by chance, aircraft did get within vicinity of the radar contact for the FLIR to be positioned onto that piece of the sky. And they did pick up energy coming from that point. So the FLIR is slave to look at the radar's designation. So at one point they're flying toward one of these objects. They had it on their radar. And as they traversed in the vicinity of it, the FLIR looked at it, stared at it, and they noticed IR energy coming from it. I would notice that. So what it looked like for me is if there was just energy kind of coming out of that point of the sky, and it, almost as if someone was shining a flashlight down my sensor. I wasn't seeing, as you see in the image here, the skin of an aircraft. I wasn't seeing exhaust, even when they're moving, no exhaust. I'm just kind of seeing the fact that it was almost like something was shining at me. IR energy was being reflected at me. So. Yeah, and they would typically be cold as well on the IR. So I can select white hot, cold hot, white hot, cold hot. And we would, we'd be able to see that the temperature was relatively colder than the surrounding, which was surprising towards us. So at this point, this really kind of amped it up for us. And we kind of took like a pause for a second and said, hey, there's very likely something physical at these points in the sky here. This is now a big problem because these things were out in our area. People were flying by them and not giving them a second thought. And it's probably more a matter of luck than anything else that we didn't have a midair before we were aware of this. So. Better lucky than good, we always say. Next slide, please. Once the word was out that something was there, of course, some people wanted to take a look. And shortly thereafter, we did end up getting our eyeballs on, but this particular story was purely by chance. There was a flight of two F-18 Foxtrots in my squadron with two aircrew in each aircraft for a total of four aircrew. As they're flying out to the entry point in that area, which is a standard location at standard altitudes that all aircraft go in or out of the area. One of the objects, it appears, was at that entrance point. So as the two aircraft were checking into the area, one of these objects basically flew right between the section. The aircraft were probably in the vicinity of about 100 feet apart from each other. So the object was very likely somewhere in the vicinity of 50 feet-ish if it did go directly between them, but it's very difficult to just eyeball gauge size and distances in an aircraft. But when they came back to the ready room, the people that saw it, they were in the ready room with their gear on, which is atypical. It's typically we want to get the sweaty hot stuff off as soon as possible. Hey, what's up? And he just had a very surprised look on his face. And he says, hey, you know those things that we see? Well, I almost hit one of those things. And then he described it as a dark or gray cube inside a clear sphere where the kind of the corners of the cube were touching kind of the surface of that clear sphere. I don't know contextually how you see a clear sphere, so I don't know what that necessarily translates to in reality, right? So there must have been some type of way he visually could make out that sphere. What that means, I don't know. He estimated 50 and 30 feet. Again, very difficult to make estimates, especially when it's a split second near miss like that. We did, of course, have continued visual encounters after that, people going out, taking a look. But it's very difficult to see them. We would have them on the radar. We'd have them on the FLIR, our joint helmet mounted cueing system, which is pumping all this information onto our visor and also tracking your head movements, is showing us exactly where to look for the object as we're coming to emerge with them. And we do this all the time. We train to this. This is not an abnormal thing to come to emerge with an aircraft for us. So as we come to these merges, this thing that we do all the time, we're highly trained at for dogfighting, it was a hard time seeing them. We couldn't see them. So many of us will go out, we zip by, try to slow down. We couldn't see them. Sometimes maybe it would appear like they would descend a little bit, which unfortunately kind of indicates our ability to see them if they just kind of drop below the belly of our aircraft that was flipping over inverted, which I'm sure some did, but we are also making sure we don't hit these things out there. So we are giving them a pretty healthy buffer. So take that for what you will as far as the visual acuity thing, but you know, our box and our sensors are showing us one piece of the sky. So what's the difference between this first, you know, near miss and the second one where it's hard to see them? I don't know, but we can talk about that later. Right now we're kind of getting a little ticked off in the squadron because for us, our first inclination that this is some type of classified drone program that we're not aware of and someone is testing it where they should not be, and something needs to be done because we're going to take out an aircraft with possibly two souls on it. So that was our primary concern at this point. Next slide, please. Responses midair, we did submit a safety report and then a number of subsequent safety reports, which are now in the public sphere. And I'll let you read this quote from my commanding officer at the time, who's basically acknowledging the fact that no one is probably looking at this information, but this is the only avenue with which we have to report these safety issues. Next slide, please. All right, so fast forward a couple of months here, and we are going out to do our workup cycle for our upcoming deployment aboard the USS Roosevelt. And during that workup cycle, we head down to the Jacksonville coast where we do training for a number of months. Some highlights here, we were aware that there was foreign intelligence gathering operations in our vicinity, which are relatively routine. You know, when we arrived out into the area, the objects were there. So they were either already there when we arrived or they followed us there, and I don't have any data to support either one of those conclusions. While returning from one of our flights, an air-to-air flight, a relatively large, maybe eight aircraft, I was in a flight with, I believe it was three other aircraft. We went out to conduct our mission. As the missions are ending and people start coming home due to being low on gas, it's typically one aircraft at a time. We don't just all come back at the same time. One of the aircraft I was flying with picked up a radar contact and flew over a bit on their way home to investigate. Once they landed, they debriefed, showed the tapes, what I'll talk about here in a second, but the image they captured is what you see on the screen here. I'll let you look at that for a quick moment. Of note, this is the FLIR and this is in IR mode, not camera. Next slide, please. All right, so what was happening outside of the small clip that folks may have seen already. So on the situational awareness page is kind of where all our data is getting pumped into. And we typically look at that to receive offboard information or even our own onboard information in order to identify targets or all the stuff that we do up there. So what was interesting was that on our situational awareness page, what we noticed was that there was a, and I use the word formation here, there's a formation of about 4 to 5 aircraft flying in what resembled a wedge formation. And as they were flying along, they began a turn that had some type of radius of turn, right? So it wasn't an instantaneous direction change. It turned as if it was cutting through the air. And they were a bit jumbled, right? So they didn't maintain perfect formation. They kind of scattered out, almost looked semi-random. And they were at separate altitudes as well, but not, so they weren't at the exact same altitude. And as they rolled back out, they basically did a 180 and started flowing in the other direction. The object, the gimbal object from the image before, is represented in this slide by the circle with the line going through it. And this object was proceeding behind the larger group. And essentially, it approached and then it stopped for a bit. And then as the formation turned back 180 degrees, it just stopped from that position and then immediately went in the opposite direction, more or less, so that there was really no radius of turn, as I was highlighting on the formation.
2 minutes.
Sorry, Ed?
2 minutes.
Got it, thank you. What was very interesting here was that the formation, they appeared on the radar similar to the objects we would normally see in Virginia Beach, but the large gimbal object was something we had not seen before. Next slide, please. All right, so this was intended to just be a quick talk about this. I would like to get more into the safety conversation here as we continue forward, but I think it's very important that people understand that this is a very pragmatic thing for me. This is not, I'm not a UFO guy. This is all very new for me. My concern is the fact that we are almost hitting something that's out in our working areas with very expensive aircraft and with people at risk here. The UAP task force report that came out said that in the past 2 years, there were 11 near misses within the data set that they studied. Those are the ones that A, haven't studied, B, that were reported in the past 2 years. So thank you for coming and listening to this. And I appreciate any help that can be had with this safety issue that we were experiencing.
Brian, thank you so much. I appreciate all your points. So now we go to a question and answer for Ryan. Please, people, go ahead.
Hi, Ryan. This is Chris Plain from the Debrief Head Science Writer. Can you hear me okay?
Hi, Chris.
Hi. All right. First of all, thank you for your service. Could you give me a general ratio here? You mentioned a number of radar contacts without visual, and then you mentioned a handful of visual contacts. Would you say we're seeing hundreds or even thousands of radar tracks, and we only have a couple of visuals? What sort of ratio in your experience?
Yeah, it's tough, right? So a typical day in the areas, I would typically see, and again, I don't necessarily represent every single person here. So everything I say is my data set or data set I've talked to people about, and there's a lot of other people there. So I would typically see somewhere between like 2 and 5 objects in the working areas, when I was up there. So times that by however many years that's been going on. I have heard maybe people have visually seen it maybe somewhere in the vicinity of 8 to 10 times. And that is me not asking people and people just telling me, so I have no idea what the ratio is, but, obviously we're seeing a lot of them, but that data set is only about, 10 visuals. What was very interesting though, when I was deciding to even do any of this and talk to anyone, I was sitting in the ready room with about 10 people, and I asked everyone in the room if they remembered those things that were flying around there. And basically everyone that was on the East Coast, there was people on the West Coast too, but the East Coast guys immediately all knew what I was talking about. And one even said, hey, oh yeah, the cube things in the sphere, So I said, okay, we're not crazy here. So,
would you say that description of the visual, the cube with the sphere inside, is consistent across the cases where people are reporting physically seeing it?
So far as I've heard, and again, as people have talked about the issue that we've been having on the East Coast, which is, been reported to me happening on the West Coast and possibly further inland as well. But yes, that's far as I know.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Hi, Ryan. This is Peter. I have a question. What you described there as that kind of that gimbal object, and then the in front of it was these those things in front were the spheres of the cube inside, and is that right? And then when this gimbal object stopped, and did it instantaneously change direction? I mean, did it stop and then just move, because that would be a huge acceleration if it was moving and it just stopped and then went in another direction.
Yeah. So to answer the first part of your question, yes, to my best assessment, the objects that were in the formation resembled on the radar resembled, the radar contacts I was seeing in Virginia Beach, the Cuban sphere.
So it's like this thing is shepherding these things somehow. There's an appearance of it.
I don't have enough information to make that assessment, right? There could be a lot of architectures at play if we're looking at any type of swarm mechanics here. In the answer to the second part of the question, which was?
You said it came to a stop.
Oh, yes. Changed
direction.
Yeah. Yeah. So I don't know, right? If there, the line between probably an infinite acceleration, if there's a zero time component at that change in direction, and a very small one, is not something I can assess from what I saw.
Well, I mean, not instantaneous, but I mean, very quick. I mean,
the best I can recollect, there was a pause in between the direction change.
All right. Yeah. Thank you.
All right, I wish I could be more specific, but my goal is, unless I'm like 100% sure, I'm very timid about
absolutely
making that last 1% connection, saying it did happen.
Ryan, hi, it's Philip speaking. I have a question. Thanks for your presentation. During the first presentation of Ravi, and it's a similar question I had, he reported that there's a term in a report called signature management. Does it have a special meaning in term for the military pilots, and did apply to the sightings that you just described? What does it mean, signature management? Thank you.
Yeah, that can mean a lot of things. And yes, it is a term that I am very familiar with, and the tactical aviation community is very familiar with. Not to say that the way we use that term is the exact same way that UAP Task Force uses that term. But, I think everyone immediately goes to, visual signatures, right? So, can you see it? Can you not see it? Is it some kind of cloaking thing? Is it a, an RF blocker, right? So can you not see it with the radar at all? Or, can you see it? Is it a something that can detect you're there, but perhaps it's passively detecting you instead of actively detecting you with a radar? That would be some sensor management thing. So it's a big conversation, and unfortunately, a lot of it probably goes classified, but I don't know whether my understanding of that term is the same as UAP Task Force.
Thanks, Ryan.
Okay, Ryan, I'll have to cut it off here. We can pick up later on the general Q&A. Again, thank you very much. Also, I was remiss to mention in Ryan's background to everyone that he also holds a bachelor's and a master's in aerospace engineering. So with that, again, Ryan, thank you. And we'll continue on to our next speaker.
Thank you, Ed. And I just want to correct the record very quick. I actually do not have a master's.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. Thank you.
My mistake.
Good job, Ryan.
I apologize, we had a plug up on top that was preventing going into the next file. So I will reconnect, see if we can do a little bit better.
Permission to make a comment.
There we go. Our next speaker, Ted Rowe. He's a director of research, National Aviation Reporting Center on Anomalous Phenomena, otherwise known as NARCAP. He co-founded NARCAP, along with Dr. Richard Haynes, a NASA Ames senior research scientist at the time frame of 1999. NARCAP overall documents and analyzes UAP reports from pilots, explores trends in the data, and promotes research and analysis through publication and outreach. NARCAP is a nonprofit research group. And with that introduction, Ted, I'll turn it over to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ed. And a thank you to the organizers and, of course, to our hosts, the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics. This is a rare opportunity and one I've hoped for a long time. My name is Ted Rowe. I'm going to talk to you a bit about civil aviation and aviation safety matters, because that's been our primary thrust for the last 20 years. So we've listened to cases and incidents, and with Ryan, he's brought up some safety factor issues. I'm going to expand on that a little bit more. Next slide, please. Thank you. During his 40-year career at NASA as a perceptual psychologist and human factors expert, Dr. Richard Haynes collected over 3,000 aviation-related reports of incidents and observations involving lights and objects the air crews could not identify. In 1999, he prepared an analysis of 100 safety-related incidents involving American air crews, and he titled it Aviation Safety in America, a Previously Neglected Factor. And inside of this, he identified several specific safety factors associated with UAP encounters. Close pacing is the first one. This is where, now keep in mind, we're talking about civilian aircraft, commercial air crews. Okay, these are not fighter pilots. They're flying on a trajectory, they're zooming along, getting from point A to point B. So one of the more common reports we get are close pacing. When we have a UAP pull up near the aircraft and pace it for any period of time. Another is loss of separation to less than 1,000 feet, collision headings and high rates of closure. So we have the object coming right at you and you may feel that you need to put in a control input. Near mid-air collisions, concurrent electrical system failures, and we're going to talk a little more about that in a minute, intermittent radar detection, crew distraction, and incursions into Class B restricted airspace over airports. All of this creates safety hazards. All of these are safety hazards that have been reported to us. That's just 100 examples. We have many more. Next screen, please. In the process of preparing this study, Dr. Haynes repeatedly encountered underreporting bias. Pilots and air traffic controllers often do not report these incidents and observations out of fear for their reputations and their careers. And compounding the matter, the Federal Aviation Administration, the FAA, does not accept or analyze pilot or ATC reports of UFO. And per the FAA Aeronautics Instruction Manual, the AIM, Chapter 774, refers them to civilian organizations. So they're, nobody wants to talk to a pilot that's seen a UFO in civil and commercial aviation. Reports and information regarding aviation safety-related UAP incidents and observations flow away from the aviation system and safety planners, leaving air crews with no leadership guidance. And this is a problem that I'm hoping that this discussion today will help gain some leverage on so that we can start collecting data directly from the aviation system. Next screen, please. So during the summer of 1999, Dr. Haynes and I discussed his study and decided to develop a data collection program to gain more information. It was clear that the aviation community wasn't being served on this subject at the moment, and we felt that lives were in the balance. Due to the apparent underreporting bias, we decided to set up a confidential reporting system modeled after the FAA's aviation safety reporting system protocols. That way a pilot can contact us, we can validate that he is a pilot and he is who he says he was, and then we can de-identify his case before it goes public, minimizing repercussions on him and his career. We also defined and introduced the term term or UAP to provide a more accurate and less stigmatized term. I know Robbie offered a definition in his presentation. Dr. Haynes has had one since 1980. And it's fairly clear. I didn't post it up here, but it's on our site. And then we conducted a search for historical information about aviation-related incidents and observations that might involve UAP, because we're waiting for pilots to talk to us, and they're not running at us in droves. In the process, we participated in some briefings. We briefed congressmen in 2003, participated or supported a congressional hearing in 2005. We briefed the FAA's aviation safety reporting system analysts in 2003 or four, I think it was. We were invited to join a research agreement with the government of Chile's UAP research team, the Committee for the Study of Anomalous Aerial Phenomena, or CEPHA-A. And we gained a cordial relationship with the French research program, CNES Japan. We've supported research teams. We've led research inquiries like Project Sphere, which involved multiple authors examining all different aspects of UAP that present as spherical targets. Next screen, please. Our primary interest and focus have been on safety-related incidents. If it didn't include safety factors, we documented it as an observation, but we didn't include it in our safety data. We were very interested also in UAP appearances and characteristics, flight dynamics, and human factors around, including the underreporting bias, and understanding the cause of resistance to UAP research by the aviation and science community. We worked on identifying and developing relationships with international teams and researchers while advocating public, which is who we actually serve. If you can go to the next screen, please. We develop our data from several sources, the first being the reporting center. It's not that well known. We've been around 20 years, but we haven't been promoted widely in the aviation system, so we don't have an endless stream of observations, and we're certain that there are more cases out there than we are aware of. We receive up to a dozen cases per month. Most are historical reports. Some are resolved. There are one or two cases per year that are actionable and may resolve as unidentified. In that case, actionable cases are reported within days of the occurrence so that we can generate Freedom of Information Act requests and retrieve audio and radar data. Interviews are conducted, and if the case remains unidentified, they're added to the database. Historical cases are documented, interviews conducted, and added to the database if they're not resolved as mundane. Additionally, one of our international technical specialists, Dominic Weinstein, prepared a catalog of 1,300 pilot reports ranging from 1916 till 2000. And that's been a very helpful source as well. If you could go to the next screen, please. And what we learned is that there are profiles of UAP and common characteristics. They share common characteristics. They share common flight characteristics. And then we were able to understand the incident profiles involving aircraft. So if you could, next screen, please. So the four UAP profiles commonly reported by pilots, the first three are objects. They're disks or spheres, they're cylinders. And then finally, there are balls of light, which are in a separate category, and I'll explain that in a minute. All of these objects can range in size from a few feet to larger than commercial aircraft. And they've been reported in every variation by pilots for the last 100 years. And they're the primary ones that we see when we look at our 1300 case file. Next screen, please. So when we look at balls of light, they're very interesting, all right? Because we don't know if they're masking an object or not, at least from our perspective. Perhaps our military radars can tell us something else, but when we see a ball of light, we aren't certain what's going on there. We know that ball lightning has a duration of 5 to 7 seconds. These things have ridiculous durations. They come into view, lit up, and they leave lit up, and if they're there for an hour, then you have an hour of illumination. They have no visible surface other than the light. They're highly mobile. They have long durations. They can range in size from a few inches in diameter to larger than commercial aircraft. They're intermittently detected on radar. Sometimes we get them, sometimes they don't. A pilot will call in and ask for radar confirmation, and most of the time he won't get it. And this is a problem for safety factors because airborne collision avoidance systems that operate on radar won't detect them. And if they're not using TCAS, of course, transponder-based collision avoidance systems won't detect them either. Sometimes the reports involve multiple observations. There'll be anywhere from 2 to 5. That's what we've seen in our files. I'm sure there are other cases of more. They appear in different colors and seem to coincide with a specific emission spectrophic atoms. A common color that we see in these phenomena is orange, and that suggests helium band. We have white, whitish greens, we have violet, we have green, we have red. So that they range in that across those colors, and they seem to suggest that they're plasmas. We're a strong inclination there. Dr. Haynes and Dominic Weinstein prepared a study called the NARCAP Technical Report 3, examining 57 cases of concurrent reports of electrical system failures during a UAP encounter, and all 57 cases involved balls of light. So there's some important clues in understanding balls of light and whether they represent something like an operating mode, you know, when one of the spherical objects decides to go into another mode or movement, that they implement a plasma shield around them. I don't know, but so we aren't really sure, you know, what they are, but we do know that they affect aircraft. Next slide, please. Now, all four of these UAP profiles share common characteristics. As Ryan mentioned and others have mentioned, there's no thrust port, no visible thrust, no blast. They're quiet. Ground observers describe them as silent. They do not use propulsive thrust and aerodynamic lift. They don't have wings or lifting surfaces. They often appear with a glow or a distortion around them. I've seen personally in our research and studies, I've seen a disk with an orange, very defined sphere around it, and the disk fit exactly in it with nothing hanging out, if you want to call it that. And all four share the same flight characteristics. So if you go to the next screen, please. UAP have been reported by pilots to hover and to move very slowly, and as our other speakers have described, perform explosive accelerations faster than the eye can track. They can perform sudden decelerations to a dead stop or a hover, and I mean like snap, dead stop in midair. They can perform angular turns at speed. They don't have wings, or they don't deal with hydrodynamics per se, so they don't fly around a heading. They just change headings. So the presumption is that they experience little or no resistance to change in velocities or heading. They can move in any direction from any observed position, and they can move without orienting to a vertical axis. Somebody else mentioned that earlier, that they fly in ways that might seem counterintuitive. For example, you might see a cylinder flying end up, or end forward, or broadside. You might see it rotating, you might see it helicoptering. All of these are reported in these observations. Next screen, please. And our preliminary findings include the incident profiles. UAP observations and incidents have been reported over every region of the planet and can happen anywhere at any time, and that has nothing to do with weather or anything else. UAP observations and incidents have occurred from ground level to above cruise altitudes of commercial aircraft. A recent case that I worked involved a freight hauler over Mexico. It was a 767. They were cruising at 38,000 feet doing around 500 miles an hour when the UAP dropped into view from above and for 32 minutes. The pilot got out his cell phone and started shooting video of it, which was bokeh because the camera kept auto-focusing on the windscreen and then on the object. So you couldn't get a really good view of what they were looking at outside the window. But then he turned around and he aimed it at his radar, onboard radar system, and there was no target at all. And this is the thing that we're concerned about in safety factors. You can't detect these things unless you see it. You don't know it's there. The idea that perhaps it will get out of your way because somebody else cares about not hitting you is just a hope. We don't know. And even if it is somebody operating on the other end, you can have mistakes. Things can happen. So pilots are unsupported in this area. They're often undetectable by radar. Most reports begin with a visual observation by the crew. So you rarely have air traffic controller vectoring aircraft away from UAP targets. They don't detect it first. And the primary safety factor with UAP is for the commercial and civil aviation crew is that they're unexpected and unpredictable. We don't know when they're going to happen. And on top of it, they don't know what to do. And there's nobody to tell it to once they have one of these incidents. So these are like real issues as far as dealing with UAP and when you have souls on board. It's very interesting to look at the physics of these things and to chase them around with our F-18s and try to understand what they're about. But lives are in the balance here, and many more flights take place on any given day than military flights all over the world. So if you can go to the next screen, please. Next screen, Ed. Thank you. And one thing we've learned about these profiles is that they all share common flight characteristics. Well, that went backwards, Ed. Next screen. Thank you. No, back one. Thank you. Okay, so UAP and incidents and observations have a low frequency of occurrence, and that's a preliminary estimate based on a limited aircrew survey. We don't encourage pilots to talk about these things, so we really don't know what the real numbers are or how often they occur. We do know that incidents can be quite harrowing, particularly when they involve multiple objects, or depending on the phase of flight that the aircraft is in. If they're in a landing phase, takeoff phase, somewhere critical, unplanned control inputs could lead to catastrophe. And for those who are listening, who are researchers, who are looking, trying to understand how they might open a research effort here, aerial UAP observations and incidents are supported by ground observations. So a lot of what we see, what pilots are reporting, is also being reported by observers on the ground. And you can look at the observer databases there and see very similar observations of UAP and very similar reports. There are also places where UAP occur repeatedly. Hessel in Norway is one of them. Professor Erling Strand at Oswald College has maintained an observation program at Hesdalen for about 30 years now, collecting automated data from his blue box, he calls it. Learned in the process is that there are many other sites where these things occur, and I've actually spent some time with Mr. Strand in other locations where we've observed unidentified aerial phenomena in transit, in motion. So finally, I would say that the most important thing that we can do to understand UAP from the aviation safety context is to develop a focused global reporting program that will provide a larger sample and offer a clear perspective on the scope and nature of UAP and their implications for aviation safety. In other words, we need more data, and it starts at home. We need to start backing up our pilots, encouraging them to report, and then exercise due diligence with the reports. And make sure that data is secured somewhere public so that researchers can look more closely at them. And that's about all that I have to share right now as far as aviation safety and commercial aviation going at this point. If you have any questions, I'm happy to take them on.
All right, Ted, thank you so much. Quick apology for the momentary hiccup due to a Zoom message that interfered with the process. Anyway, so let's move on. Question and answer for Ted, please.
Hi, Ted. This is Chris, head science writer over at the Debrief. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, Chris.
I had one clarification question on the characteristics of balls of light slide. You mentioned 57 documented cases reported concurrent failures of electrical systems.
Yes.
So obviously, since this is a safety issue, I want to make sure I'm reading that right. Is that of all the cases that were studied by NARCAP, the ones that had electrical interference were all balls of light, or all the balls of light cases were creating electrical interference? I'm trying to understand what that means.
Okay, so all of the cases where pilots reported concurrent failures of onboard electrical systems also reported during a UAP incident described the UAP as a spherical ball of light.
Okay, so none of the other form factors you mentioned, the disks or spheres or any of these other things, have concurrent electrical failure. It's just these ball of light cases.
We have no data reflecting electrical interference from any of the other UAP. But of course, this is very preliminary and we need much more data in order to fully understand what these things are capable of.
Okay, great. That was my main question. Thank you.
Ted, I have a question. It's Peter Rialli here.
Hi, Peter.
I briefly dropped out. I had a networking problem here. Well, I may have missed some part of it, but are there any incidents actually causing a crash of an airliner or anything like that, or that you know of?
The problem we have is validating it. We have stories, we have pilot reports. I have newspaper clippings of pilots that claim they hit flying saucers. The low survivability of air crews and the intermittent detectability of UAP on radar makes it difficult to tell if they played a role in a catastrophe. And so we're kind of stuck with that, but we have lost aircraft. The Mantell case is an example. He was the ground observer corps saw UAP. His Air National Guard unit was vectored to it. He chased it far above his oxygen level, blacked out and fell to the ground. But it was a safety factor of his own making. It was pilot error. But we have lost pilots in UAP interactions, yes.
I just wondered if black boxes ever have ever reported anything, you know?
I don't know. That goes to the NTSB. And the NTSB, I don't think, takes on UAP cases. The only case I've ever seen that they took on that was that where they said it was a UFO involved a Cessna 208 on a climb out from Mobile, Alabama. He got to about 3,000 feet, yelled, "I have to divert, I have to divert, I have to divert." And they found him balled up in the swamp with his propeller laying somewhere else. So they know he hit something. There were transfer marks on the aircraft that didn't belong to his plane, and they never resolved what it was he hit. There were speculations that he hit a drug runner that was flying in the shadow of a nearby wide body, but that was never validated or confirmed. There was speculation that it involved a UAV out of a nearby military base, but that was never confirmed either.
Thank you.
So as far as I know, NTSB doesn't touch these things at this point until there's a sea change around the topic of UAP investigations and accepting pilot reports. I doubt they will. Anyone else have any questions for me?
A question for you, sir. Santosh Kumar, a member of Pilots Association and Slico Fair Space Teachers Working Group. And
You're not coming through. You're breaking up. I'm not getting you.
Maybe it's the same person, Ted, but there was a note on my screen that showed that somebody had their hand raised to ask a question. And if it's not the same person, please go ahead.
Yes, I'm available. Anybody has anything to ask? Let's see, any messages? No.
All right, Ted, why don't we wrap it up then? And
all right, thank you.
My sincere thanks. And we'll go on to our next speaker. Hi. Our next presenter is Philippe Allier. He is currently with the European Space Agency as a project controller. It should be noted, though, that this presentation is undertaken as a personal work, not necessarily endorsed as research activity by ESA. Also, he's a board member of, as stated, UFO data, but we'll just say UAP data, and is a project that advocates to utilize a large network of automated surveillance stations with sophisticated sensors to monitor the skies 24/7, looking for aerial anomalies. In 2009, Philippe also founded the UAP Observations Reporting Scheme project that collects UAP reports from the astronomical community. And with that, Philippe, let me turn it over to you.
Thank you, Ed, and good afternoon, everyone. I hope you won't have any problem to understand my French English, but I will try my best to be clear. So thanks also to the organization and to the organizer of this session. So I think as a sixth and last speaker, and as a logical follow-up of the previous interventions, I'm going to talk about some concrete approaches now, which will have for objective to better detect, study, and characterize the UAP phenomena. And hopefully, we'll be able to better predict such events in the future. Next slide, please. All right. Having said that, I would like to start my presentation by providing a few points of general context. And I would like to underline the necessity of not only collecting UAP reports from trained observers like air crews, but also in acquiring instrumented data. And I think Ravi made the point very clear at the beginning. Of course, we are all very pleased to observe since a few months the favorable trends surrounding the UAP discourse, and we hope that this will facilitate in the future the reporting of sightings and encourage also a true scientific research. For sure, in order to make progress on learning more about the nature of UAP, there is the need to implement better data collection, not only in terms of enabling the reporting of serious observations, like air crews, but also in engaging in instrumented approaches to acquire UAP data. So such reports and data are absolutely necessary for the scientific community for engaging in research and learning about the physical characteristics of UAP. Overall, it's my opinion that different strategies and courses of actions need to be pursued in parallel in order to increase our chances of finding a solution to the UAP challenge. Next, please. Concerning the aviation world and atmospheric science, you should be reminded that scientists had previously not paid sufficient attention to eyewitnesses' accounts, including airplane pilots, of some peculiar flashes or some giant flashes of light illuminating the sky above thunderstorms. And it is only at the end of 1989 that some university researchers accidentally captured such natural phenomena, filming them on a low video camera. Since then, this research activity has really progressed to the point that a special instrument has been launched in 2018 to the International Space Station and is currently studying such phenomena from low orbit. The main point there is that I wish to make here is that aircrews are good witnesses of unusual phenomena, and they should be really encouraged to report their UAP observations, as they could represent a new and important atmospheric phenomena like the sprites or something else. And I think the previous speaker also emphasized very well this point. Next, please. So about the UAP Task Force report, when I read it, I spotted the comments regarding the reticence to report UAP observations. This reminded me that in Europe, it was the same comment that was raised already 20 years ago within a Project Condyne, which was a secret UFO study undertaken by the British government's defense intelligence staff between 97 and 2000. It was a report that was released into the public domain in 2006. This project reports mention also there was evidence that airplane crews were seeing far more than they were reporting due to the fear of ridicule or also the potential effect on company business. So like the previous speaker, my important message today is that we are facing a stigma which exists since decades in the aviation world, and that it's really time now to take concrete action for mitigating it. Obviously, the justification for encouraging UAP reports should be twofold. Firstly, maintaining or improving flight safety, and secondly, related to the part of the human intellectual curiosity, which seeks to extend our knowledge, leading potentially to new scientific discoveries, like in the example of the sprites. Once this topic is taken seriously, then science can move forward. Next, please. Now, I would like to propose a first important concrete action directly connected to the promotion of safe flight. I would recommend first that access is requested to a few selected aviation databases, the ones collecting information on safety incidents or special occurrence, and to extract UAP incidents and perform a thorough analysis. This would help understanding better the UAP occurrences and guide future research. Different databases exist, and we could start by selecting a few of them, like the following ones: the FAA, which has an unmanned aircraft system database, allowed despite the difficulties that have been mentioned by the previous speaker. It will also be useful to add the NASA database that they maintain themselves, called the Aviation Safety Reporting System. And of course, in order to complement that by having a global perspective, we should consult existing relevant databases outside America. Canada would be a good choice via the Civil Aviation Daily Occurrence Reporting System, or CADORS. And in fact, a special request could be raised towards the private company NAV Canada for accessing the report themselves. Outside North America, the United Kingdom Civil Aviation Authority and a scheme called the Mandatory Occurrence Reporting could also be included. Also, in this UK case, access will only be possible via a special application, justifying it by the objective of maintaining or improving aviation safety. Next, please. So it is obvious for all that just the collection of good sighting reports and examining aviation database won't be sufficient. The only way to resolve this lack of understanding about UAP phenomenon is through serious scientific study. As mentioned today by Dr. Ravi, ultimately, any new research will need to engage in collecting new data going forward. Such effort should lead to a systematic collection of credible and high-quality data. Although this is a great challenge, there is also time for exciting new possibilities nowadays, and I would like to share with you now two positive developments. First, this scientific approach is much more durable than before. This is due to the rapid evolution in information and sensor technologies in terms, for example, of availability of off-the-shelf scientific instrumentation, powerful computing, sophisticated software, and ubiquitous high-speed internet access, all of this at a lower cost than before. And secondly, because I think that we have enough technologies available, that dedicated and expensive systems don't necessarily have to be built. Instead, we could rely on collecting UAP data through existing systems. So I will now, for the rest of the presentation, talk about these two approaches, which in fact demonstrate that UAP can be studied with the tools of physical science. Next. To illustrate such approach, I would like to say a few words about field instrumented missions. And I was glad that the previous speaker mentioned the Hesdalen research. Since several years, and not only in Norway, but also in Italy and France and America, various civilians, associations, and few scientists attempt to detect and analyze UAP using scientific equipment and placed in the same geographical location from where UAP sightings have been reported. The project Hesdalen, located in a small Norwegian valley, is a leading example of such effort. In fact, this project represents the longest active fieldwork as it started in 1984 and is still operational nowadays. The objective being to capture data across the electromagnetic spectrum, and therefore a wide range of equipment is deployed here, as illustrated on the side, Despite the fact that there's unexplained lights have appeared at random intervals, the project had obtained throughout the year several successes of optical and radar detections. A few examples are shown. But another point that is that we have to make clear is, in fact, the objective of this project by Norwegian scientists is to discover the physical mechanism causing the sphere of lights. And a few Norwegian researchers think that such knowledge, for example, could open the way to breakthrough technologies for lighting applications or energy sources. Next, please. So a second example that I wish to present is related to the US-based project called UFO Data that Ed has mentioned and to which I participate. The project is not yet operational, but in fact, important progress has recently been made with the building of the UAP monitoring station appearing in the picture on the side. Such said station is, of course, consisting of suite of instruments which will be able to measure many characteristics of UAP as displayed, including visible and non-visible light spectrum, local environment factors, and others. The station will continuously run for 24 hours a day, and data will be recorded by most instruments only when an event will be detected. And of course, afterwards, several unique artificial intelligence capabilities will be used in order to reduce the false alarms. However, compared to Hesdalen, the UFO data project will follow different strategies in order to increase the chances of collecting UAP data. Overall, the principle is to build a public science of UAP thanks to the deployment of a large international civilian network of automated surveillance stations that will be connected to an event data server. Next, please. As I mentioned in the introduction, I believe that different strategies are needed in parallel and that there are already existing technologies that could contribute well to the UAP research. One promising new method that I would like to present to you relates to the use of civilian Earth observation satellites and associated data. After all, the single site where we can learn the most about our planet is nowhere on Earth but high above it. The satellite images that are acquired on a continuous basis are powerful scientific tools to increase our knowledge of the environment. So one possibility is to use the civilians and governmental free open satellite data to mine for UFO data. In fact, this sounds not a very good concept, especially after I read the declaration of the former intelligence director who mentioned that UAP had been picked up by satellite imagery. And also, I have read with interest the latest FAQ from NASA, which makes a reference to search strategy now. So next part of the presentation, I will explain why I think this represents a potential promising research method for detecting and collecting hard scientific data, but what could be a potential application, and also some first ideas for databases extraction strategies. Next, please. So in order to realize the potential importance of satellite technology for UAP research, let me briefly recall the main advantage of the Earth observation satellites. In this case, I use the example of the two European Sentinel-2 high-resolution optical imager satellites, which are currently in orbit. So the satellite capture regularly on a regular basis the data. Second, they have an excellent precision, like up to a few meter resolutions. Third, they cover a very wide geographical zone, including areas very difficult to reach and several environments, and on a continuous basis. the archives of the satellites are kept, and mainly in order to see the environmental trends over a long time. And like in this case of his European satellite, part of the Copernicus program, these satellite data access are free. So next, please. So in parallel of the unique abilities of the benefits of Earth observation satellite, should be mentioned that during the past years, technology and satellite companies offering to scientists have increased dramatically, and the trend is going faster. The world observation data is rapidly changing due to two factors. On one hand, there's a huge increase of number of Earth observation satellites launched into orbit, and obviously this results in a massive increase of data collected. And on the other hand, also, there are many different actors that are entering the market with many new ideas to build and put in orbit full constellation of satellites with the objective to cover an image constantly and every day across the planet. So on the other hand, in parallel of this huge increase of Earth observation data, there is a very rapid advance in the field of artificial intelligence with now unprecedented capacities to retrieve and analyze all this collected data. So I think combining all the two together, I think this overall create an unprecedented opportunity for examining Earth observation satellite data to search for aerial anomalies, UAP, or unusual signatures. Next, please. So in order to illustrate first this concept and the potential application, I will show you first some examples of optical pictures taken by the Sentinel-2 Copernicus satellites. As you can see on the screen, the main point is that flying objects like airplanes can easily be observed on pictures, as the satellites are even at an altitude of 780 kilometers. And the instrument is covering a wide swath of 290 kilometers wide. So the shape of the object, in that case the plane, is quite clear on the images. Next, please. The rainbow image is a composite product, in fact, combining three spectral bands of the satellite, which allows reconstructing a red, green, blue, false colored image. As I explained on this slide, this is in fact a single airplane, as the scaled color patterns for the moving airplane and the contrail is due, in fact, to the physical distance between the filters aboard the satellite. Next, please. The interesting thing, according to me, is that knowing the fixed attitude of a satellite and the physical distance between the different sensors on the instrument aboard the satellite allows to retrieve some relevant important parameters, like, for example, the size of the plane, which can be calculated in relation to the number of pixels on the image. The velocity and the altitude of the plane can also be derived via calculation. So to me, it seems that this could represent a potential application for UAP research, as some new specific algorithm could be built for the detection of flying phenomena in satellite optical databases and for the extraction of potential area anomalies by applying some threshold on such parameters. For example, we could detect phenomena related to the observables that have been mentioned in a previous presentation in relation to peculiar shapes, observable structures, aspect ratios of the flying phenomena, or pictures at abnormal altitudes, or reflecting some abnormal velocity. So to make the link to the aviation databases, we could even think perhaps using satellites data to first detect and characterize UAP that have had near misses with aircrafts. And even at the end, all what we have are optical photos, not spectral or any other data. This would already be a step forward, according to me. Next, please. So obviously, there will be the need to refine the algorithm searches in order to reduce the time to sift through huge Earth observation archives. I list now on this slide some first ideas that I had about spatial and time-based analysis methods that could be applied, and some logical ones, of course. And depending on how feasible and time-consuming such extracting algorithm could be, and applying artificial techniques like machine learning on them, we could, for example, going through some satellite optical archives and attempt to detect, as I said before, anomalies via threshold on some observables, or we could try to retrieve data from the same date and location of specific credible UAP event, like aircrew sighting. This could be even an aviation report or a sighting that has been identified in one of the archives of the Serious Ufological Association's reporting systems. Or perhaps we could even systematically retrieve data for the same geographical area over a long stretch of time, like the Hesdal in Norway, or any location where there's suddenly an increase of UAP activity, like around the east and west coast of America. Perhaps a good idea is we could target location and period during special events, maybe like during a special deployment of military forces or training exercises, because apparently UAP activity seemed to increase during this period.
2 minutes.
Next, please. So in fact, we have reached the end of my presentation, and rather than summarizing what I just told you, I think I would rather bring forward these three complementary points. So for sure, the UAP is an enduring mystery that has been going on for even over 70 years at least, and it has relevance, as we see today, that to the aviation, the military, and a lot of citizens. So I think that today we have, and compared to the past decades, we have the technological capability to study it, and we have the opportunity to make progress. And at this moment, as a last point, is the UAP subject is gaining legitimacy, and the stigma is being reduced. But now it's really the evolutionary responsibility of the scientific and professional community to engage in this research opportunity. Research, such research which is difficult, requires proper funding and proper course of actions and strategies. Thank you. This will conclude my presentation. Thank you. And in case of any question, I'll be happy to hear. And I hope everybody understood me. Thank you.
Philippe, thank you. And most engaging. And your points spoken quite well. Definitely in comparison with my ability to speak French under the same set of topics. And I'm sure many share in that sentiment. So again, my sincere congratulations on that and appreciation. Now, let me start off with question and answers for Philippe. Please go ahead.
Hi, Philippe. This is Christopher Plain, head science writer at the Debrief. Can you hear me okay?
Very well, thank you.
Great. You gave some imaging and other examples of how satellite data might be used to add shed some light on the mystery. Is that a proposal to use satellites that are already in service and having them retasked, or was this a proposal for satellites dedicated to this project?
No, my proposal is, as I said before, is the tools already exist. And it will cost too much to develop new specific system as a starting point, I would say. So we have to take advantage of what is available. And there's the possibility to use already highly calibrated and very effective satellites instruments. So we should take advantage of them. And in that case, there are several databases that are already available for free. Of course, we can also contact specific satellite private companies who also have archives in order they would help, but then we'll need to pay them. I don't advocate for building a satellite and launching a satellite dedicated to UAP detection, although maybe a very small satellite could be down.
So you're recommending both utilizing the databases of information that are already captured and stored, yes, from existing satellites, as well as potentially tasking them to specific events.
Maybe I was not clear enough. I think we have to build up algorithms to retrieve data from the existing satellite databases.
Okay,
databases. Now, because the next step is much more expensive and you will need much more expertise and technical abilities, time and money.
Great. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Hi, Philippe.
Hi.
Hello?
Hello. Yeah, yeah,
okay. Okay, great. Really fascinating talk. Thank you. I was curious about the Sentinel-2 ESA satellite and what specifically is kind of the technical reason for the satellite doing these Earth observation images from three different spectral bands over time, over the course of its orbit. I'm curious to know just why it's already doing that.
The Sentinel-2, and with the optical instrumentation, was devoted to the analysis of the vegetation, in fact, especially for helping crops and to understand the situation, the health status of the crops. So it's for agricultural reasons on the ground, because they can detect through the different instruments how dry is the ground, if you need to water, and if you what is the health status, if you need to put more products in order to make it improve the crops production. So it was mostly for this kind of the nature of this agriculture and for feeding people, basically, at the end of the day.
Yeah.
Increase the capacity.
So with the airplane and the contrail, is the fact that this is like a very white, bright object that's reflecting the entirety, the reason that it's producing this effect?
Alors, if I may compare, in the past, we had these spy satellites or these defense satellites, and they were taking just pictures above specific points, specific time. Now the satellites are evolving in a kind of following a carpet mode picture. They acquire continuously picture across this swath. So you have a huge amount of data. And of course, when they pass across areas, they will take a picture of anything that is in between. So my idea is, we could use this opportunity to try to progress in a field. Of course, the satellite is not dedicated to this kind of survey, but the advantage is they are there. You don't need to develop an instrumentation, and the data normally is available. What needs to be done is the building up of the specific algorithms and retrieving of data and analysis.
Understood. Thank you.
Thank you, Matthew.
All right. Philippe, that will finish up our time allotted for the individual speaker Q&A. And I want to thank you again. And we're going to go on to a quote-unquote unscheduled element to our panel and give everybody a little bit of a background beforehand. And that is, as we've heard from all the excellent presenters, if you will, for a bit of a tawdry explanation on my part, is a simile, is each one is looking at this environment of UAP through their specific wavelength in the spectrum. And when we had planning meetings relative to this special session, I proposed a challenge to the group to think about, well, each one of you are going to make great presentations, which you have. But at the end of the day, where do we go forward from here? And I threw this question to the group, and to their immense credit, they decided to get together and come up with what they would think would be a few conclusion charts going forward. In other words, where do we go from here to present to this audience? So as a bit of a bonus, if you will, we're going to review those charts. And it's my understanding that Ryan Graves has been selected as the spokesperson for the group to give you their combined assessment of where do we go from here. So let me go ahead and get those up. And Ryan, if you would, I'll turn it over to you, please.
Yeah, hey, thank you. As I said, these recommendations were compiled by the entire group. And you know, the idea here is that, you know, we're trying to get some core messages across that I think are probably, you know, not going to be a surprise. You know, but what needs to happen here isn't something where, you know, we can look to you and tell you what needs to be done. You know, this is going to require a lot of different specialties, you know, from tactical aviation to physics. And so, you know, we need everyone's help on this, and we need to do it in a way that is transparent, you know, because at the end of the day, you know, like I said, very pragmatically, you know, we're flying around objects out there that, you know, hundreds of miles an hour with, you know, people's families on board. And it's just a matter of time, frankly. I'm surprised it hasn't happened already. But anyways, with no further ado, next slide, please. All right. So one of the, I think, the biggest takeaways here, and I'm going to just read it right off. The DNI report indicates that some UAP are real objects. Scientifically studying them should not be stigmatized. Recommend additional sessions introduced with key science aerospace meetings. So I'm even hesitant to, you know, ask people or to state that this shouldn't be stigmatized. For me, it's a silly conversation because, you know, I know for a fact that this is still happening. There's still aviators that are briefing this as a safety consideration every single flight they go on. NOTAMs have been filed. And this is all the very pragmatic, you know, everyday safety considerations. When we consider potential tactical considerations, that's another whole conversation. But this needs to be resolved, and we need all hands on deck. We also believe that a formation of a panel of experts from different disciplines are going to be required to identify needed data collection methodologies and instruments. So we understand that there might not be inherent expertise in this anywhere, whether that's on the UAP task force or elsewhere. So we recommend that a scientific and engineering panel is established and is coordinated in various subjects with some leadership in order to talk to lawmakers and provide their opinion on things such as potential R&D opportunities or paths forward. Additionally, we believe that historical data availability is crucial. We recommend an established routine availability of unclassified sensor data on UAP for peer-reviewed scientific analysis. So I think we all would like to see a reality where this is a problem that everyone is working on, and that when a conclusion is drawn, it is done so in a peer-reviewed manner for scientific analysis, not just in the United States, but worldwide. So we would think that we would want that data out, and we would want that as the gold standard of evidence. Next slide, please. Just kind of get into this, a couple other points that we thought were important. The panel of experts, the civilian scientist panel, we believe that their responsibilities would lay with curating unclassified data for public consumption and understanding. So the expectation is this group would be clear, just like any other group from a defense contractor, into programs at the appropriate level or collections at the appropriate level in order to consume data. And if there is unclassified data that can be shared, then they would be responsible for ensuring that was communicated to the public effectively. Additionally, they would be representing the public's interests to ensure any potential scientific discoveries were available for peer review, including the data. They'd be responsible for advising the government of UAP R&D based on the data that is available and the, you know, the direction that is agreed upon by both the government and civilian groups. Again, this will consist of scientists, engineers, subject matter experts in the relevant fields, I don't think there's a couple specialties that would sum everything up here. So I think there's going to be a pretty wide group of specialties that are going to be required in order to answer the questions that need to be answered in a timely manner. And I imagine that list of specialties is going to change over time as we learn more about what's going on here. Next slide, please. Civilian safety focus. The fact that we're talking about Sigma still in a time when people are having mid-airs, or correction, near misses, is disturbing. So we need to make sure that the military is already underway in this process, but we need to ensure civilian aircrew feel comfortable submitting aviation safety reports related to UAP air without fear of retribution, by creating a standardized FAA UAP reporting protocol that is pushed out and that aircrew are trained to in order to ensure that we are receiving accurate data from the civilian aviation community. The civilian scientist panel would be available for data analysis, as well as further coordination with the FAA for radar analysis, for debriefs from aircrew, and any other data that could be gathered. And I'll pause here, Ed. That is it for our recommendations, and I'm sure there'll be more conversation to follow. Thank you.